Hello there, welcome to the Sare channel and welcome to my omnibus series. I've got so many of these omnibuses that are going to come out so that you'll be able to listen to an hour's worth of stories, which I know you're going to love. You know, the thing is that telling stories is such a fine art, and it's something that was practiced hundreds of years ago when people didn't have the technology that we have today. And everyone would gather around the fire and listen to a wonderful story. And also, what is so wonderful about a story is that, personally, I think it is the best way to go to sleep. Every night when I go to bed, I always listen to stories. And that's something that parents used to do with their children. It's something that they still do with their children. There's nothing better than a good story. And so I hope you're going to enjoy this series. And before we start, I just want to say, do subscribe to my channel, because you don't want to miss out on anything, because I'm in for the long haul and I want to make sure that you get the most stunning stories to go to bed with at night, or to listen to when you want to be one of those people sitting beside the fire and listening. Don't forget to subscribe to my channel and let's get started. I hope you're going to enjoy the omnibus.
Dear Sarah and all your lovely listeners, 30 years earlier, it was so silent and dark when Chelsea finally opened up her eyes. With the blackout curtains drawn in her bedroom, she could not be sure exactly what time it was. It could have been in the middle of the night for all she knew, or early in the morning. She reached out to pat her husband Rick's side of the bed, and it was stone cold to the touch. This meant he'd likely left for work a long time ago, dropping their 8-year-old daughter Ashley off at school. How long had she been fast asleep for? She was lightly in the house all on her own, although she could feel the 2 weighted, reassuring lumps at the bottom of her bed, and could see her 2 cats, Willow and Safi, curled up together in a tight little ball, a mohair bundle of sorts, keeping themselves lovely and warm. She could feel a definite chill in the air, as winter was teetering into spring, but the mornings were still nippy, which made getting up early a laborious challenge, most especially for her husband Rick, who had to leave their house while it was still dark outside. Rick would drop off their daughter Ashley at her parents' house, and fortunately her parents lived across the road from the local school, which was awfully convenient for the family. It was Rick who'd insisted they'd installed the blackout curtains, so that during the summer months, the intrusive glare of sunlight in their north-facing bedroom would not rouse them from their restful slumber too early, as once Rick opened his eyes, he struggled to get back to sleep again. So the blackout curtains had been a godsend for the couple. Chelsea wrestled with the blankets that cocooned her like a chrysalis bound up in silk, untangling herself from the knots of her bedsheets. Rick was always tirelessly complaining that during the night Chelsea stole all the bedsheets for herself. It was true, something she felt incredibly embarrassed and rather sheepish about. It meant that Rick would go to bed, always having to wear a couple of extra sweaters to keep out the cold. She gingerly climbed out of bed, moving over to the curtains, shocking the darkness out of its shadows with the unabashful glaze of the intrusive morning light that bounded into the bedroom like a mischievous child. It even startled the 2 cats at the end of the bed, who slipped out of their sleepy state, looking up at Chelsea with half-opened green eyes, both crawling hungrily towards the bright yellow puddle of sunlight that dappled the duvet cover, and settled down in their new warm spot, basking delightedly in the thrilling disturbance that the sunlight invited. They fastidiously set to work, grooming each other's coats meticulously, with pink tongues as rough as sandpaper. Safi was a blue Burmese, Willow a chocolate, both with the most affectionate natures that made them more like dogs than cats, something well known about this breed. Chelsea stood at the bedroom window, staring out at the beleaguered, stone-washed countryside of the bluegrass state that had looked so weary and subdued for far too long, as if the cruel, punishing hands of winter had wantonly stolen the last summer's beauty away and callously thrown bleach all over her face. But spring, with a resolute determination and a buoyant steely grit, was fighting winter back to pave a way for the approaching summer, with a vengeance like two men engaged in a duel. And winter had underestimated just what a tough contender spring actually was. For her sweet whispers of gladness and promise of new beginnings and great opportunities caressed the countryside, like the fragrant splashes of pretty pastel colours thrown onto an artist's canvas. The dogwoods in the woodgrove were adorned with ethereal blossoms, and the green grass was doggedly pushing its way through the coarse brown grass. Butterflies and bees could be seen teasing the yellow daffodil heads. It was clear that at long last winter was receding, but she was still fighting back, like a foe that had not quite accepted defeat, not just yet. Chelsea was glad for the rejuvenating long sleep she had enjoyed. It had energized her, but she knew she needed to go downstairs to let her two golden Labradors, Montreal and Toronto, out of their large crate, so that they could run around the countryside to their heart's content. And as usual, when she opened their crates to let them out, they were bounding around outdoors with a spirited ebullience, barking at trees and earnestly sniffing the ground to follow trails and secret scent messages delivered to them by nocturnal visitors that had lightly visited the farmhouse the previous night. She could see Eric Hopkins' old rusty truck parked in their driveway, its front window clouded by mist. It was always good knowing that Eric was around and about. He had become such a fixture and fitting in their family's lives. And even her daughter Ashley called him Uncle Eric. He was loved so much, it would be strange if he were not around. She could see he had let their six horses out into the field. He was laying down hay for them to eat, and when he saw Chelsea he lifted up his hand to wave at her. She returned the wave, watching from a distance, smiling to herself contentedly, as her two Labradors threw themselves frenziedly at Eric, as if they hadn't seen the man in three generations. Eric squatted down on his legs, taking the two dogs lovingly into his arms, roughing up their short golden blonde hair. Eric had a magical way with animals, and her two Labradors thought the sun shone out of Eric's backside. Chelsea suspected the horses felt much the same way about the young man. Eric managed the affairs of the farm with an effortless ease, making his very challenging job look like it was just a piece of cake. He cleared the riding trails in the grove, chopped firewood, cleaned out the barn, mucked out the stables, managed the upkeep of the house, doing odd jobs here and there, fixing anything that was broken. He ordered all the food for their horses, and was one of those useful people that could turn his hand at absolutely anything, and never needed to be told what needed to be done. And who does not delight in a hard worker like that? Chelsea considered him indispensable in every sense of the word, and was sure that they could not function without him being around. He was like the essential heartbeat of their farm, and without Eric the farm would likely go into coronary arrest, and she had told Eric that often enough. Eric lived with his grandmother in the nearby town, and arrived at their farmhouse promptly before the morning even broke. Later in the morning he'd pop into the family farmhouse to enjoy a coffee or tea, or to make himself a sandwich. He was considered like a member of the family, and was often invited over to enjoy supper with them, to watch television, or to play board games or cards. Chelsea watched Eric being magnanimously assaulted by her two dogs, with their flamboyant love display that they had showered all over him, with an impressive sequence of jumping jacks and slobbery wet kisses.
"That's enough, Montreal, and you're no better, Toronto," Eric had chuckled, raising himself back to his feet, brushing them away. "If you lick me any more, I will melt like a popsicle. We can't have that, can we?" he joked.
Eric put down the rest of the hay for the six American quarterback horses to enjoy, who were happily standing in the field under a couple of oak trees that were covered in tiny crisp green leaves, chomping the hay, their sleek coats dappled by the pretty light of the new morning. Eric wiped his hands happily on his faded blue jeans, and eagerly sashayed towards Chelsea, climbing through the middle panel of the wooden fence to get to her. He was wearing on his face his wicked, mischievous grin that lit up his blue eyes and made you like him at once. Eric was the kind of person everyone naturally loved, as he wore his heart on his sleeve, and had a naturally kind disposition. Eric walked with the elegant gait of a cowboy, his boots grazing the brown grass now bespeckled with tenacious green shoots, and he approached Chelsea eagerly.
"How are you, Chelsea?"
he said with a warm twinkle in his eyes.
Good question, Eric. Very good question. I guess you could say I'm still acclimatizing to the morning. Those blackout curtains made me believe it was still dark outside. I really didn't want to get out of bed this morning. And those two Burmese cats of mine certainly make me believe sleeping in all day isn't half such a bad idea. Look at me, I'm still in my PJs and dressing gown. What time is it, Eric?
She asked, letting out a sizable yawn.
I didn't even bother to check the time on the hall clock this morning. It's about 9:30, said Eric.
Chelsea gasped.
Did I really sleep in that long? Goodness gracious, that is insane, isn't it? It's good for you, Chelsea, said Eric. If you slept in so late, your body obviously needed it. That's what my grandmother's always telling me. She says if we listened to our bodies more attentively, we'd be a whole lot healthier, we'd be. And our bodies know how much sleep we actually need. People underestimate, Chelsea, the importance of good sleep, you know. Without it, we don't function at all well. You're just being nice, Eric. Making excuses for me so I don't feel bad about being such a lazy slob. No wonder I like having you around. You're forever a gentleman. Even when I look like something the cat dragged in, you're always so incredibly complimentary about how I look. When you tie the knot one day, Eric, your wife will be one lucky woman, she'll be. Even if she has a bum the size of the bayou in New Orleans, you tell her it's small. Those are the kind of men I really like.
Eric blushed, his face growing red from the compliment.
I'm a long way off from getting married, Chelsea. But thanks for the compliment all the same. In truth, flattery is not really my thing. I wouldn't compliment you if I didn't mean what I was saying. And for the record, if I did have a wife with a bum the size of the bayou in New Orleans, I might just drown.
At that, they both laughed. Eric was about 22 years old, but he looked every bit like a handsome cowboy, with his bright blue eyes, golden-coloured complexion, and honey-blonde hair that hung around his head in long golden strands, that gave him that surfer-meets-cowboy sort of look. But he didn't have that dopey expression you might see in a carefree surfer. Eric was as sharp as a hawk, and nothing slipped past his beady eyes. He knew everything going on in the farm, and even the species of birds that nestled up in the trees. On this prepossessing spring morning, with the sun spilling through the blue clouds, he was wearing a black cowboy hat, a brown and black plaid jacket, blue jeans, and a pair of cowboy boots. And even if he was covered in hay or muck, he always looked incredibly good. And Chelsea marvelled at that. How could anyone look great after mucking out the stables? But Eric always did.
Spring is on her way, he said, patting Chelsea on the back. Which is good news, is it not? Look how frisky the horses are this morning. They're enjoying the sunshine, they are. You can almost feel their abundant happiness. And Bluebell is in a very good mood this morning. Exceptionally so. I've never seen her this relaxed. I tell you what, Chelsea, I'll go and put the kettle on, shall I? You go and get changed, or you might just be tempted to stay in your PJs all day.
You're right, Eric. I better go and get dressed. Thank you, Eric. You really are a star. What would I do without you?
Now there's a very good question, said Eric teasingly. I could only imagine your lives would be a chaotic mess without me around. Everything would go to seed and fall apart, he joked.
Don't you dare joke, Eric, said Chelsea. I'm being deadly serious. Things would almost certainly fall apart if you were not around, and I mean that unequivocally.
Don't underestimate yourself, Chelsea, or sell yourself short. You're a very efficient woman. You could manage things very well around here, if I were not around.
That's where you're wrong, Eric, Chelsea insisted. When Chelsea came downstairs into the kitchen a while later, it smelt of toast and coffee. Eric beckoned for her to take a seat on one of the upholstered farmhouse chairs at the long kitchen table that could seat over 8 people. There was a bowl of fruit displayed in the middle of the table, and Eric had laid out 2 placemats to protect the wood from any spillage. The two yellow Labradors, after an exhaustive run in the countryside, were lying at their feet, drifting into a pleasing sleep. Chelsea and Eric began to enjoy their coffee together, and Eric always made a mean cup of coffee.
"This coffee is excellent," said Chelsea. Eric grinned. "Of course it's good, Chelsea. I made it. Did you not know I've got magic hands?" he said, lifting up his hand and looking at it as if it was a magic wand. Chelsea giggled. "Something weird happened this morning," he told her. "I've been meaning to tell you about it. And when I say weird, Chelsea, I mean weird. In truth, I cannot make any sense of it. But believe me, I'm trying. And when I say this morning, I'm actually talking about last night. But I discovered it this morning."
"I'm listening," said Chelsea. "Go on. I'm intrigued."
"Well, I don't know exactly how to explain it. But all the horses that I put in their stable blocks last night were in different stables in the morning. Now, how do you explain that, Chelsea? For me, it's a bit like figuring out an advanced mathematical equation that is not adding up. The horses were moved during the night, not by me. So who the hell moved them? It certainly wouldn't be Rick moving the horses. Your husband visits them, but he leaves all the management to me."
"What on earth are you talking about, Eric?" asked Chelsea, looking befuddled. "What do you mean the horses moved? You're not making any sense."
"What I mean is exactly what I say," says Eric, "that I have assigned a stall for each horse. I know which stall belongs to which horse. Every night I settle them down to their own individual stall before I actually leave, and they know which stall is theirs. But in the morning, when I return to the stables, everything had enigmatically changed. I found them all in different stalls, and I didn't move them at all. So how do you explain that?"
"You think someone moved our horses during the night?" asked Chelsea, looking bewildered.
"I don't think, Chelsea. I know someone did exactly that. Either that, or I'm going completely stark raving mad, and I'm not. So yes, someone was on our property during the night, and they moved our horses around."
"But why would they do such a thing?" asked Chelsea. "That is extraordinary. Were the horses very distressed and upset? You know what they can be like. They're not comfortable with strangers, especially Bluebell. She's a skittish horse if ever I saw one. But then again, look at her this morning. It's like she's had a personality transplant, or she's taken a whole packet of Xanax. She's so incredibly relaxed. I've never seen her like that before."
"The horses are unusually calm and relaxed this morning, Chelsea. And like I say, Bluebell is a temperamental horse at the very best of times. If anything had upset her during the night, she'd be more stressed out than ever. But this morning she's very content. Indeed, I've never seen her this relaxed before."
"It is incredibly bizarre, Eric. I honestly don't know how to explain that conundrum."
"It is bizarre," agreed Eric. "You took the words out of my mouth. Bluebell doesn't trust any other handler beyond myself. So something rather peculiar is going on here," he said, removing his cowboy hat and placing it by his placemat, running a hand through his honey-blonde hair, his eyes expressing his obvious confoundment. He let out a sigh. "Oh, I hate mystery like this," he said to Chelsea. "I know something is going on, and it's making no sense to me whatsoever. It's driving me insane. Even when I was a kid reading a mystery novel, I always read the end before the beginning. I needed to uncover who murdered who. The suspense always killed me. I love thrillers, but I can't help myself needing to know the answers. So mysteries I can't always deal with. And not knowing how the horses ended up in different stalls last night is so perplexing. I can't answer it, and I hate not knowing."
"I'm sure there's a reasonable explanation, Eric," said Chelsea. "Was anything taken last night? I mean, there are expensive saddles and stuff in the tack room that is worth quite a lot of money.
and would probably be desirable for thieves. Nothing has been taken. So this was not a robbery, Chelsea. It was the first thing that I considered. But everything is exactly as it should be. But I did find some long dark hair, snagged on an old nail against one of the walls of the stables, that I have not seen before. It looks like human hair, but is the colour of midnight. And there was a sizable footprint on the edge of the stable. Absolutely enormous it was. Never seen anything like it before. Whoever was on the property last night had feet the size of the abominable snowman and was not wearing any shoes. Who does that? Long dark hair, caught up on a nail, said Chelsea, looking perturbed. And huge feet. Well, lots of people have large feet, but people don't go around without wearing shoes. Well, we did have a lot of rain last week, and it's been very muddy around the place. So it is very possible that those footprints just got much bigger after the rain. But seriously, Eric, if it was not a robbery, how about a practical joke? Could one of your friends be messing around with you and have come over to the farm and tried to toy with your head? It wouldn't be the first time that someone pulled a prank on you, Eric. Remember when you put a scarecrow in that field of corn we had? Because of the birds. Then you found a scarecrow hanging high up in a tree like a Christmas ornament. You wondered how anyone could have placed the scarecrow in the tree like that, because it was beyond reach. Yes, but even that I never found out who did it, said Eric. And they pulled the same stunt 2 or 3 more times, I might add. But you are right. It's as if someone's playing games with me. But it would certainly help to know who the practical joker is. It is a possibility it could be my cousin Nick, and he might be behind all this. He's renowned for playing tricks on me. But even he would not pull a stunt like this. He's useless with horses. I doubt he'd have the ability to remove them at night from their stalls, unless he had help from someone who knows their way around horses, which is a possibility. I think I'm going to set up a game camera clandestinely up in there to see what's going on. I have a sense that this is going to happen again. Someone is definitely toying with me. I want to catch them in the act. And if it's my cousin Nick, I'll have his guts for garters, believe me. Mess with me and I'm fine. But don't mess with the horses, for goodness sake, because then I'm not a happy camper. That's a good idea, Eric, putting up a game camera, I mean. It'll put our minds at rest, especially if we find out that no one with duplicitous intent was messing around with our horses or scouting the place for the purposes of a robbery. I mean, you do hear stories, don't you? And I want to know that we have not got some unwelcome trespassers on our property. The thing is, if there are people hiding on our property, they would try to keep a low profile, surely. Not draw attention to themselves like this, which is exactly what they've done by changing the horses around. Talking about trespassers, are you expecting anyone? Asked Eric, looking out of the kitchen window that overlooked the driveway. They observed a car moving purposely down the driveway, throwing its engine into the death rattle, until the noisy engine suddenly spluttered and then died a very fast death once the car was finally put into park. Chelsea looked befuddled, her hands tightened over her warm coffee mug. She didn't like spontaneous drop-ins from strangers. She watched the parked car in the driveway of their farmhouse. For a brief moment, the stranger remained in their car. And then finally, slowly but surely, the driver's side door opened. A woman got out, and Chelsea narrowed her eyes to observe the stranger more closely. The woman was elegant with a sweep of straight blonde hair and bangs that framed a heart-shaped face. She was wearing faded jeans and a snugly fitting leather jacket that accentuated her narrow frame. She appeared to be waltzing over to the trunk of her car, her blonde hair swinging behind her like a billowing curtain. She was pulling out a sizable suitcase that looked like it was packed with gold bullion, as it clearly weighed a ton. What the hell, thought Chelsea, scrunching up her eyes and looking at Eric with a bemused expression on her face. "She's getting a suitcase out of her trunk," she told Eric, "that she's struggling to actually lift. What the hell? She looks as if she's intending to move in with us. And by the size of that suitcase, it looks like she's folded up the entire state of Nebraska in there. It doesn't look like she's intending to leave any time soon. Why don't I like the look of this, Eric?
Do you even know her? Asked Eric.
No, I've never seen her a day in my life. She must have got the wrong address, surely. It has to be that. Maybe she thinks we're a bed and breakfast. That must be it. There are quite a few bed and breakfasts around here, you know.
The woman walked over to the passenger side door and opened it. She placed her hands on her hips and appeared to be shouting at someone seated inside the car, who was clearly not wanting to get out. Chelsea finally saw a boy of about 10 or 11 climbing reluctantly out of the passenger side seat, with a disgruntled expression on his face. He looked cantankerously indignant, like an unwilling participant in a sports game that didn't want to be dragged onto the field, but had no choice in the matter. The woman snatched his reluctant arm, looping her arm in his, marching him towards the front doorstep, dragging the hideously large suitcase on wheels behind her. She moved with the kind of determined gait of a wrong teacher taking the subordinate pupil kicking and screaming to the headmaster's office for a huge telling off. What on earth was going on here? What was this mother and her rebellious-looking child doing on their property? And what was the heavy suitcase she was wheeling to the front door all about? They had to have the wrong address, surely. For a brief moment it felt as if all the breath had been expunged from Chelsea's lungs, as a rush of hot air seemed to rise from her chest up to her neck and then to her face. She didn't have a good feeling about any of this. There was something unsettling about this mother and her son, and she couldn't put a finger on it, but she felt a little flustered, rather like a fox that had been chased by a pack of hounds. "I'd better get that," said Chelsea, as she heard the knock at their front door. She weaved past Eric in the kitchen, ambling down the passageway in the entrance hall, and unbolted the front door. The woman was standing in the doorway, and close up she was not as pretty as she had first appeared from the distance. Close-up scrutiny could be most unkind, and the bright light of the spring morning was not flattering on her complexion. It lacked the benefits of the soft light in a photographic studio that could turn a pig's ear into a silk purse with great ease. Chelsea noticed tired, weathered skin that was aging before its time, like a boot that had been left out in the elements for far too long, and had been subjected to too much wear and tear. There were dark, formidable shadows under the woman's eyes, as if she was greatly sleep-deprived. The telltale wrinkles around her mouth suggested that she was a heavy smoker, so her teeth were a little on the yellow side from all the nicotine stains. The woman looked slightly haggard, rather than actually being in good shape, like someone who's had a really rough life, like a doll that's been battered around the place by the family poodle. "How can I help you?" asked Chelsea, persuading herself that this woman had got the wrong address. But the woman rudely pushed past her in the doorway, grabbing her son by the hand and leading her into the house, along with a suitcase that was choking at the seams it was so full, looking suspiciously like it would burst open like a seed pod so that the contents would go flying absolutely everywhere. She walked into Chelsea's farmhouse as if she had every right to just barge into a stranger's abode with a confident assertiveness and cocky swagger that was nothing short of baffling to Chelsea, who was completely staggered and put out by the woman's dogged impertinence. "So sorry," said Chelsea. "Do I know you? What do you think you're doing here? I think you must have got the wrong address or something. I don't appreciate people just barreling into my house like you have, as if my house is a hotel foyer, without exercising any kind of manners whatsoever. Who the hell do you think you are? And why on earth are you bringing that lumbering, great big hulking suitcase into my house? If you think this is some kind of bed and breakfast, you are sadly mistaken, my friend." The woman's smile turned into a nauseous grin. "No, I have not got the wrong address. I know this place well. It's Rick's dad's farmhouse, and I'm guessing he left the place to Rick. It's sad the old bugger died, isn't it? But then he did choose to sire children when he was half dead himself." She tuttered under her breath. "I never understood men having kids when they're long past their prime. But then again, that's Rick's dad for you. He was a late bloomer. I don't know who you think you are, my friend, but I don't appreciate your rudeness. I've never met anyone so rude in my entire life.
How do you know my husband, Rick? And furthermore, what are you doing here? I could call the cops, you know. But if you go, we'll say no more about how you presumptuously just barreled into my house like this. I'm going to make this very quick, said the woman. I need to talk to you in person, and I'll explain everything shortly. You'll feel awfully silly if you call the cops. Where is your kitchen? A coffee would be very nice, she said, ignoring Chelsea's half-hearted threat to call the cops. Eric was still seated in the kitchen, nursing a coffee and biting into a piece of toast covered in peanut butter and jelly. When the strange woman and her son entered the kitchen together, he looked at them in surprise and just nodded politely as you do. He was never comfortable with strangers. He was naturally reticent and reserved by nature. He hurriedly glugged down the remnants of his coffee. The woman brazenly, without so much as batting an eyelid, walked over to a chair, pulled it out from beneath the kitchen table, opposite where Eric was sitting. She sat down on it, gesturing for her son to take the chair next to hers, which he did so with a bored but less than amused expression on his face. His young face seemed to be permanently wearing an unpleasant scowl, and his dark eyes seemed hostile and cold. The woman rattled around clumsily in her long leather shoulder bag, as if looking for something on the inside. She finally pulled out a box of cigarettes and a lighter. She lit up a cigarette, which she popped rather gracelessly into her mouth, and began blowing out large blasts of cigarette smoke into the kitchen, so the smoke billowed over the room and floated out of an open window. Chelsea wanted to stop her smoking at once, but promptly decided against it. The sooner this obnoxious woman and her moody, truculent son got out of her home, the better. But clearly the woman had something to say, so Chelsea would hear her out, and then demand she leave at once. That would be the reasonable thing to do in the circumstances, but she was still reasonably niffed by the woman's presumptuousness. "Ah, that is so much better," said the woman agreeably, inhaling the cigarette smoke, as if it was life-giving oxygen for her, which Chelsea suspected it was. She imagined the malnourished woman lived on coffee and cigarettes as the mainstay of her diet. Of that Chelsea was most sure. She was not the embodiment of good health. Indeed, a close-up picture of her on the back of a box of cigarettes might put you off smoking for life, for this young woman at one time could have been quite attractive, Chelsea decided, but certainly not any more. From a distance, yes, but close up, it was bad news. The woman grabbed Eric's empty coffee mug and dragged it across the table to her side. She began using the coffee mug as a makeshift ashtray. "Sorry about that," she said apologetically to Eric, not looking sorry at all. "I don't want to get ash over the table. I like to respect people's property, you see." "I think I better get going," said Eric, whose face had grown as red as a field of poppies. "I'll make myself scarce, shall I, for you ladies to have a nice talk," he said uncomfortably, feeling that perhaps it was not his place to remain in the kitchen with female company around. "You're staying, Eric," came Chelsea's firm, demanding voice. She didn't want to be left alone with this strange, manic woman and her truculent son. The woman was making herself sumptuously cozy at the kitchen table, as if she had every right to be there. Ostensibly, in Chelsea's opinion, there was something profoundly off about the both of them, and she had taken an instant disagreeable dislike to this woman, who was, for some reason, making her skin crawl. She didn't like self-entitled people that walked into your house as if they owned the place in the way that this woman had done. Who the hell did she think she was? She had a bloody cheek and seemed to enjoy ruffling up Chelsea's feathers, like the family dog might enjoy stressing out the chickens in the coop. "Are you making that coffee or not?" said the woman coquettishly, giving Eric a big wink. "I have mine black with no sugar. I'm sweet enough, you see," she said, laughing at her own joke, as if she thought she was hilariously funny. But no one appeared to be amused. "What is all this about?" asked Chelsea curtly, as she rolled over a mug of black coffee towards the woman. "You better make this quick and then go. Even my two golden Labradors are not happy with your presence. I have never heard them growl at a stranger before, like they're doing to you now." "There is no need to be so abrasive. Look at you, you're as tight as a sailor's knot," said the woman. "Oh dear, oh dear, I think somebody got out of bed the wrong way, did they not?" she said scathingly, looking at Chelsea through narrowing eyes. You must be rather dithery. Did you know you're wearing your sweatshirt inside out? I do, as it happens, said Chelsea, her face flushing pink with indignance. I don't like the logo on front of my sweatshirt, so I deliberately turned it inside out. Not that it is any of your business. Let's make this quick, shall we? Who are you? Might be a very good start. The name's Rachel Carson. Has not your husband Rick told you about me? Naughty, naughty boy, she said, shaking her fingers. But why am I not surprised? She said mischievously, the corners of her mouth twitching upwards, as if she was trying her best to suppress a huge grin. The woman took another puff of her Marlborough cigarette, blowing out a large cloud of white smoke directly into Chelsea's face. It caused Chelsea to wheeze and her eyes to water. She smacked away the smoke in disgust with the back of her hand. She hated smoking of any kind, as being a reformed smoker herself, she had a particular aversion to smoke, especially in her farmhouse, as you could never get the smell out of the curtains and the furniture. The woman's eyes narrowed with a smug, self-satisfied look that reminded Chelsea of when you were playing a game of cards and you knew you had a killer hand and that you were going to walk away with the prize, leaving behind you a trail of defeated players who were less than amused. She tuttered, "Oh, Rick has been a naughty boy, has he? Didn't tell his little wifey about me. I wonder why not," she said, blowing out her words with her smoke, leaving them suspended in the air. "Would you kindly please stop playing games with me, because I'm not amused," said Chelsea. "I'm going to have to ask you to leave, Rachel Carson, or whatever you call yourself. I have no idea who on earth you are. You waltz into my home demanding coffee, acting like you own this place, which you most certainly do not. I'd like you very much and your son to please leave. Whether you know my husband or not is no concern of mine at all. I'm very sorry, but you are not welcome here. This is not a glorified B&B. And just so you know, I can direct you in the right path to find one. But you're not going to make yourself comfortable in my home, and I'd like you to go." "You heard the woman," said Eric in a stiff tone of voice. "She'd like you to leave now. I will help escort you off the premises," he said, rising up from his chair, gesturing the woman and her son to follow his lead. But they remained resolutely anchored to their seats. Well, at least the woman did. She had the look on her face of a very mulish bull terrier that was not going to do what it was told, no matter how many treats you threw its way. "You can't do that, just throw us out like this," said the woman. "You're going to kick out your stepson, are you?" she said, tapping her son's shoulders. "This is Tyson," she said. "Tyson, meet your stepmother, Chelsea." The boy sat there just glaring at Chelsea, showing not a hint of warmth towards her. It was obvious he was equally as obnoxious as his mother, but he didn't want to be in Chelsea's kitchen, any more than she wanted him here. It was his mother that had tethered him to his chair. "Stepson," said Chelsea, "are you trying to wind me up? My husband has no other children apart from Ashley, our seven-year-old girl. I have no idea what you're talking about, but I can assure you he does not have a son." "Oh, but he does," said Rachel, looking defiant. She almost looked as if she was enjoying the shock she'd brought into the household. "You're lying," said Chelsea. "Me and my husband Rick are very close. We don't keep secrets from each other. I think if we had a son, well, if he had a son, I'd know all about it. You can't make this stuff up and expect me to believe your nonsense." Rachel's eyes narrowed. She gave Chelsea a manic grin. "Well, sadly, lover boy's been very, very naughty. Naughty, naughty boy. He's been keeping a big, big secret from you," she tuttered. "He knocked me up when I was 18 years old, he did. And he never told you about me, did he? But then 3 years after I had fallen pregnant and had my boy, he married you. After you fell pregnant. Let's just say he did the right thing by you and not by me. But then again, I wasn't so lucky, possibly because you were the one that came from the right side of the tracks and I did not. He considered me trailer trash, I'm most sure. He was a bit of an inverted snob like that. What on earth are you talking about, lady? I know my husband Rick never had a child with you. I would know about it if he did, and frankly, even if he did, make you pregnant, that is. He didn't commit to you because, let me tell you, lady, you are frankly not his type. It's nothing to do with my husband being an inverted snob, as you say. He's not like that. My husband is one of the most kind people you could ever hope to meet. He's got great integrity. The woman laughed. Tell yourself what you like, lady, if it makes you feel better. I would like to remind you the name is Chelsea, and I would prefer it if you'd call me that. Well, let's just say, Chelsea, I think your husband Rick has been a naughty, naughty boy. I'm his dirty little clandestine secret that he doesn't want to share with anyone, let alone you. The quintessential skeleton in the cupboard he hoped would stay deeply buried underground and never see the light of day. Unfortunately, skeletons can get restless, as this one has. So unfortunately, you are staring at your husband's skeleton or dirty secret rudely in the face, which can't be easy for you to digest, Chelsea. But I'm not making this up. If you must know, he's been paying me regular child support for the last 10 years or so. I suppose I can't fault him for that. He's been good to his son over a distance, visited him twice a year, sent him presents for birthdays and Christmases. But it's not enough. She opened her purse and pulled out an old card, tossing it over to Chelsea, who looked at the envelope and the card, opening it up. It was a birthday card, addressed to the woman's son, written in her husband's distinct handwriting that Chelsea would know anywhere. Chelsea stoically read the card, her face paled, her eyes widened, her mouth dropped open. This could not be happening. This could not be happening. This was an absolute nightmare. Eric reached over the table to squeeze her by the hand. "Don't get upset, Chelsea," he reassured her. "I think Rick will explain everything to you. Maybe he has his good reasons for not telling you about his son. He's very protective towards you." The woman sniggered, contorting her face, so that she suddenly looked quite ugly. "I can't say I'm surprised," she said. "It's typical of Rick not to tell you. Your husband didn't want his own parents to know about my pregnancy. He was so ashamed. So why would he tell his little sweet wifey? I think he thought his mother would force us to get married. Your husband was happy to have a one-night stand with me, was he not? But when he found out he'd made me pregnant, he didn't want to commit to me at all. I was the daughter of the woman who at one time had been hired by his parents to clean the family home. He didn't want anyone to know he was the father of my baby. I guess he thought I was a piece of trailer trash, as I told you before, because I did grow up in a trailer, and he saw me as a lower form of pond life. He told me he wouldn't pay me a bean if I told anyone that the baby was his, and I desperately needed the money, so I dutifully kept storm. But I've had enough, and sooner or later...
The cockroaches have to come out of the woodwork, said Eric, completing the woman's sentence curtly.
If you want to put it like that, then you can, said the woman, eyeing Eric through hardening eyes. See if I care. It's no skin off my nose. To put it bluntly, I am tired of being lumbered with my son, responsible for doing everything.
Sorry, what are you talking about? Said Chelsea, trying to get her head around what the woman was saying. She was claiming her husband had a child with him, before she'd even met Rick. But why would he not have shared such a big secret with her? It seemed incredulous, but she didn't doubt that this nauseating woman was actually telling her the truth, especially after seeing the card written in her husband's handwriting. The startling revelation had hit her hard, like an ice pick being flung at her head. How could her husband Rick have kept such a monumental secret from her? She felt betrayed by him, very, very disappointed.
"What I'm saying," said the woman, "is that I'm giving over my son Tyler to your husband's charge. Every boy needs his father. My son is no exception to that rule. He needs his father's influence in his life. He's run me into the ground, he has, and I cannot cope with him a moment longer. He's almost 11. He's always getting into trouble.
It's about time Rick took over some of his parental responsibilities as a father a little bit more seriously, instead of expecting me to do all the work in raising our son. So I'm leaving him here with you. I need to go, she said, raising herself from the chair, squeezing the remnants of her cigarette into the coffee mug. Thanks for the coffee, and good luck with Tyson, because you're seriously going to need it.
Wait! You can't possibly go, said Chelsea. Leaving us in the lurch like this, abandoning your own son to my husband's charge. You can't go like this as if you're dropping off a stray dog that you no longer want. It's cruel, it's insane, and it's downright ridiculous. This is not how it works. I've never met you a day in my life. You barge into our home like this, dropping off your son as if it's no big deal. You just can't do that. Lady, sorry, Chelsea, I will remind you, a moment ago you were practically kicking me out of your house. Now you want me to stay. Make up your mind, will you? I want you to go, of course I do. And to take your son with you. You can't possibly leave him here with us. I'm sorry, but you just can't. I think you'll find I can, said the woman curtly. Now you'll be a good boy, Tyson, won't you? She said, leaning over to kiss her son on the cheek. Try and behave yourself, will you?
I don't want to stay here, Mum, with these strange, horrible people. I want to come home with you.
The woman lifted her son's chin to her face and stared into his eyes. Tyson, we've discussed this long and hard. You're the one that has dug your own grave. I told you if you continued with your bad behaviour, that you'd give me no choice but to drop you off at your father's house, which I've done. You are going to stay here, whether you like it or not, and you are going to have to behave. And I hope Rick will tow you into line. But now I need to leave. I can't continue to live with someone who cuts up my clothes in the way you do, and especially after you punctured the wheels of my car. I just can't live like that.
He did what?
Asked Chelsea, looking from the woman to her son in horror.
I'm sorry, Rachel Carson, or whatever you call yourself, but I cannot have an unruly, insubordinate child on my property. He'll be a bad influence to our daughter. He can't possibly move in with us. You must take him back home with you.
I think you will find he can move in with you, and he will, said the woman, giving Chelsea a watery smile. If Rick had taken more responsibility with Tyler all those years ago, maybe my son would not be such a screw-up. He needs to fix Tyler, because I can't. It's his job, not mine. I'm leaving him with you, and there's no choice in the matter. I'm sorry, but that is the way it is.
Mum, please don't go. I told you I'm so sorry, said the boy.
But the woman pushed past him, sauntering out of the house with a nonchalant indifference, as if dropping off a grocery order. And then she was gone just like that, leaving Eric and Chelsea standing in the doorway looking bemused, completely nonplussed about what had just happened.
Bloody hell, said Eric, looking at Chelsea. Are you all right? He said, putting a comforting arm around Chelsea's back. That was brutal. There is no other way to describe it. Brutal.
I don't know what to make of all this, Eric, said Chelsea. I really don't. I feel as if my entire body has gone into septic shock. I can't look after somebody else's son. Who does that woman think she is, just dumping him on us like this? What am I going to do, Eric? I saw the handwriting in that card. It was my husband's, Eric. There was no doubt about it. He's got very distinctive handwriting. I think the boy must be his son. But he never told me about any of this. Why didn't he tell me, Eric?
Don't get upset, Chelsea. Your husband is a good man. You know he is. That woman, Rachel Carson, was saying Rick would have been forced to marry her by his mother all those years ago. But Rick's mother was already dead by then. You were very young when you married Rick, and even though you were pregnant at the time, he married you because he loved you. Rick did not settle down with Rachel Carson after he made her pregnant, which speaks volumes. Maybe he was scared to tell you that he had a son with someone else, in case you rejected him. I'm sure things will work out all right, said Eric sympathetically. You can discuss everything with Rick when he gets home tonight. It sounds like he has a lot of explaining to do. I would not like to be in his shoes tonight when he gets home.
he teased. I've seen you let a lot of steam off when you're angry, Chelsea. And the kettle on a hob boiling away ain't got anything on you when you're angry.
When Rick returned home that evening, he was met by a somber, very subdued wife that looked as miserable and as overcast as a grey thundercloud. Eric, who was so thoughtful, had generously taken the young boy and Chelsea's daughter Ashley to the movies together, followed by a pizza place in town, so that Chelsea could have the house to herself to discuss the skeleton in Rick's closet that had re-emerged through the earth like an ugly weed that they needed to address. When Chelsea's husband Rick entered the house with a newspaper in one hand and a leather briefcase in another, he could sense in the cloying, melancholic silence of the house that something was not quite right this evening. Even the golden Labradors did not greet him with their usual warm ebullience, and everything seemed oddly repressed and gloomy. And the woman standing in the doorway of the kitchen, with eyes peppered and clouded with sadness and hurt, was not a sight any man would like to meet when returning from a hard day at the office.
"What on earth is wrong, sweetheart?" he asked. "I feel as if I've walked into a morgue. Has somebody died? What has happened?"
"I think you better sit down, Rick," said Chelsea, pulling out one of the kitchen chairs at the table, "because you've got some explaining to do. For your information, a young boy called Tyson has moved into our house since this morning. He came here with his suitcase and was dropped off by a belligerent, capricious woman calling herself Rachel Carson. And he's as obnoxious as his mother."
"Rachel was here?" asked Rick, his face growing red. "I don't understand. We had an agreement."
"An agreement, Rick? Is that what you call it? An agreement that I knew nothing about? How can you keep this from me, Rick? I feel utterly betrayed by you. Yes, she was here, and furthermore she dropped her son Tyler off with us. Your son, I might add. And she's insisting he must live with us now. How do you think that makes me feel? I'm completely devastated by all of this."
"What a bloody cheek," said Rick. "She didn't think to discuss this with me, phone me at all. How presumptuous can you get? I never did like that woman. She was always trouble."
"So much trouble that you knocked her up when she was 18 years old and thought not to tell me anything about the matter. How do you think that makes me feel, Rick? Did you even stop to consider my feelings in this matter? Did I not deserve to know that you had fathered somebody else's son?"
"I'm so, so sorry, Chelsea. I don't know what to say. I'm ashamed of myself. I should have told you about Tyson a long time ago. The name is not Tyler, it's Tyson. It's easy to get confused, I know. But just think of the boxer, and you'll remember his name. When I made you pregnant, I was genuinely thrilled, because I wanted to spend the rest of my life with you. But if I told you about her, I wasn't sure how you would take it. I couldn't risk losing you. So I decided not to tell you about it."
"But why ever not? I'd have still stayed with you, Rick, because I love you. It wouldn't have made any difference to me whatsoever. How could you possibly doubt my loyalty? I thought we agreed not to keep secrets from each other. What else do I not know about you, Rick? Do I even know the man I thought I married? Or am I about to find out that your mother was from the Pallades and never did die of cancer after all, as she's up there in another galaxy or something?"
"Don't be like that, Chelsea. Of course you know me, love. I don't keep secrets from you. I didn't want to tell you about Rachel Carson, because it was so awful, an awful, awful mistake that I rarely, rarely regretted. I wish to God it had never happened. I guess I thought if I blocked it out of my life, it would just go away, and that I would send Rachel Carson child support and visit my son a couple of times a year. I thought I could keep this secret buried, but obviously my plan backfired. But I am actually relieved you know about it now."
"But why? I don't get it. Why you would keep this from me? I just don't understand." Rick ran his hand through his hair and pulled at it.
"I don't know. It's very hard to explain to you, Chelsea, it really is. How do I explain it all? You see, Rachel Carlson and her mother lived in a trailer park when I was a little boy. Her mother had Rachel when she was only 15 years old. She was incredibly young. My parents gave her mother a cleaning job at the house when I was a little boy because they felt very sorry for her circumstances. She would bring along her daughter to play with me while she worked doing cleaning around the property. Rachel was her daughter, and for a long while her mother worked for my parents, until she finally got a job as a librarian at the local library, and then we barely ever saw her again. Years went by, and one day when I was 18, I met this young girl at a party. We both got drunk. Actually, the young girl ploughed me with alcohol, so I was really bladdered. One thing led to another, and I found over a month later I had made this girl, that was only a one-night stand, pregnant. In truth, I don't even remember having a one-night stand with her, but I guess it must have happened, although I have no memory of it, which is even more shameful to have to admit. I'm useless with alcohol, especially back then. It went straight to my head. Not that I'm making any excuses for myself, because I was responsible for what I did. I remember Rachel rocked up at the front door, demanding to speak to me. My father had no idea who she was, as she had changed so much. He didn't recognize her as the girl that I'd played with as a boy, and nor did I, for that matter. I remember we went for a walk in the woodgrove together, because I wanted to speak to her away from my father. I knew that she had something important to convey to me. Imagine your one-night stand rocking up at your house like a bad smell with something important to tell you. It didn't sit well in my stomach. I was filled with this sense of impending dread, because I guess I knew what she was going to tell me. She revealed to me that she was Rachel, the girl that had played with me as a little boy, a blast from the past, so to speak. When my mother was alive, she was devoutly religious. If she had known that I had made Rachel pregnant, she'd have insisted I got married to the woman. But I knew that we would be miserable together. Even as a kid, Rachel was off her head. She was weird and rather outlandish. I can't remember the things she did back then. It was so long ago. But I remember thinking very much that she wasn't all there. And even the way she behaved at that party, she was off her head, let me tell you. So when we got deeper into the woods, my heart was pounding violently in my chest. I was terrified about what she was going to tell me. And, of course, it came out. "You made me pregnant at the party," she told me. "What do you intend to do about it? Are you going to marry me or not?" I think she was genuinely expecting me to marry her. But I told her she was never going to marry me. It wasn't going to happen. "I don't love you," I said. "I can't possibly marry you. I remember you as a girl. You were strange. It would never work out for the two of us." I was brutally honest with her. She didn't take it at all well, I hasten to say. I told Rachel in no uncertain terms that I did not want to be involved in her baby's life. And if she wanted to raise her son, I would support her financially. But if she told anyone that I'd made her pregnant, she would get absolutely no money from me. Rachel then moved away to live with her grandparents in Wyoming. I sent her checks, as I promised, every month, and visited Tyson twice a year. But let me tell you, that child is trouble. So I guess that's why she's dumped him on us in the way she did. I know he's been kicked out of many schools he's attended for insubordinate behavior.
I can't believe what you're telling me, Rick. This is a dreadful mess. I wish to God you had not kept all this information from me. We can't keep Tyson, especially if he's trouble like you say he is. What kind of a negative influence will he be on Ashley's life? Surely you can persuade Rachel to take him back. Give her more money if she needs it. But we can't possibly keep him. I just don't want him here.
"Rachel is an extremely difficult woman," said Rick. "She doesn't want to be around a problem child, so she's tossed him at us.
and I'm expected to take care of him. I'm afraid I have a responsibility towards him as his father. We're going to have to watch him like a hawk, but he's going to have to stay with us because he is my son.
1 year later. There is no easy way to put this, but life had certainly not been the same for the Saxon family since Tyson had moved in with them, and his chaotic, fortuitous disruption in their lives had been most unwelcome. The child was volatile and explosive, constantly having temper tantrums and outbursts, and no matter how much Rick tried to discipline his son, the kid was completely out of control, like a belligerent dog that you could not restrain. Tyson would deliberately miss school, smoke cigarettes, drink alcohol in the school playground, and even at 12 years old, he was always disrupting classes by causing mayhem whenever he possibly could, and getting caught up in all kinds of fights in school. He had put 3 kids in hospital, but the authorities had done nothing to get this child specialist help, because he hadn't killed anyone yet, or attempted to kill them, that is. Chelsea could not cope having such a dysfunctional child around the house, whom had been diagnosed with conduct disorder, which for an adult would be literally known as antisocial personality disorder. He also had psychopathic tendencies, but there was nothing that Chelsea could do until Tyson's behaviour got excessively out of control, which she believed it already was. Then he could be admitted to a medical facility for psychiatric help. But no psychiatric hospital took anyone in indefinitely until they had committed a grievous crime, and it seemed breaking someone's rib or giving them a black eye was not enough to put him away indefinitely. He had not been deemed a threat to society yet, so it was like sitting on a time bomb, waiting for it to go off, because the Saxon family knew sooner or later that Tyson would do something really, really bad. Tyson was already in attendance at his third school, having been expelled from the former 2. The kid was not normal. Chelsea was left with a feeling that one day things would go so badly awry, and they very nearly did, had it not been for a bizarre intervention from an unlikely source that saved the day that no one saw coming.
"I can't possibly cope with Tyson living in our house a moment longer," Chelsea complained to her husband Rick. "Can't we send him to boarding school or something? Anything to get him out of this house." "Ashley's so scared of her stepbrother. The dogs avoid him like the plague, and every school he goes to purges him out like the disgusting vomit they don't want to deal with. He needs specialist help, does he not? And we're not equipped to give him that. He has locked our little girl in the yard shed 3 times already and thought it hilariously funny, while Ashley was scared to death. He shredded up her brand new school uniforms because I refused to buy him the latest pair of Nike trainers. When I told him he couldn't have a second slice of Mississippi mud pie, he yelled at me so rudely, told me I was a controlling bitch. Then he lunged at the pie and smashed the whole pie against the wall and said, 'If I can't have more pie, no one's going to have any.' It was such a dreadful mess, but he refused to clean it up. Instead, he stomped to his bedroom, locked the door behind him, put on the music blaringly loudly so that the whole house vibrated and we couldn't hear ourselves think. Later, in retaliation, he broke all the china crockery to get his revenge on me. And do you know, the other day he threw a crystal vase at me. When I told him he had to do his homework, he didn't aim it at me, but that is not the point. One of those glass shards could have done no end of damage. Besides, the crystal vase actually meant a whole lot to me. But Tyson didn't care about the mayhem he caused. Not at all. He told me in no uncertain terms to stop ordering him around. And he said, 'You're not my mother, so stop acting like you are. You don't even love me, do you? None of you do. I'm not stupid. You don't want me here upsetting your lives.' I told him I could grow to love him if he gave me a chance to do so. But it's very difficult to love anyone that's constantly causing so much chaos and pandemonium around the place. He told me I did not deserve to be a mother, because I played favourites with our daughter. 'If Ashley isn't around, maybe you'll give me more attention,' he said. That scared the hell out of me, Rick. I'm very worried about him. I am concerned for Ashley's welfare.
He's very jealous about my relationship with her. You don't think he'd harm her, do you?
Rick looked at his wife with a dismayed expression on his face.
Tyson said that to you, he said, rubbing his chin reflectively. That is a worry. We do need to watch him very carefully. Perhaps you should get Ashley to stay with your parents for a while, to ensure she's safe.
But that's only a short-term solution. How long do we have to live like this, Rick? I don't trust him at all. I've told the police about my feelings. It's been a year, and I feel as if I'm falling apart. If Eric were not around to cushion the blows while you're at work, I'd have cracked up a long time ago, you know. I don't mind admitting to you, Rick. I'm scared of Tyson. I really am. I believe everyone has underestimated what he is capable of, but he hasn't fooled me, not for a second.
Rick sighed. He is a problem child. He appears to have no emotional responses to what he does, which is a common phenomenon in conduct or antisocial personality disorder. I did apply to send him to a couple of boarding schools. I didn't want to tell you about my inquiries, as both boarding schools refused to accept him, and I knew that would distress you greatly. The kid's a liability, but no one seems willing to help us. I really don't know what we can do. Even Eric, who knows how to charm the animals, has not managed to work his magic on Tyson. And believe me, love, he has tried, giving him responsible jobs around the farm. But that boy doesn't want to lift his finger to anything. He doesn't want to be helpful or industrious. It's like he gets off stirring up trouble wherever he goes and upsetting people.
It was exactly a year to the day when Tyson's mother had brought her child to their home, and since her fortuitous arrival, nothing had ever been the same. It was as if the farm had been contaminated with a dark, cloying, repugnant energy, like a festering mould that was eating away at the family's joy. And everyone went to bed, locking their bedroom doors behind them, just to feel safe. Rick had contacted Tyson's mother, Rachel, begging her to pick up her son and take him back. But she refused to be involved in her son's life any more, and claimed she was pregnant with another man's child, whom she'd recently married.
I can't possibly take that child back. It's so good not having him in my life. And I can't put my new baby at risk. You know what Tyson's like. That boy doesn't even have a heart.
For the Saxon family, it was as if a tsunami had plundered their lives with a forceful magnitude, and everyone clandestinely wished that the problem of Tyson would just go away. And although Chelsea knew it's a terrible thing to think, she did wish that Tyson was dead, and chastised herself for these strong emotions. If he wasn't around, life would return to normal. Things would be good again. Every day she lived on tenterhooks, fearful of what Tyson would do. For she knew he was capable of causing harm. But she kept those discomposing, alarming thoughts to herself, but privately wondered if her husband felt much the same. He had certainly reacted adversely to what she had told him about how Tyson wished Ashley wasn't around, so he could get more attention for himself. That startling revelation had made Rick grow as white as a sheet, and she was sure he'd trembled in his boots. That was why he had promptly decided to send Tyson away to a camp for troubled young boys for 6 weeks, where they underwent some kind of military discipline, under the influence of two instructors who were retired from the military and were successful in nipping turbulent behaviour from troubled kids in the bud, with their disciplined, regimental, structured routines. And in the beginning it seemed to have worked, as when Tyson returned to the farmhouse after the 6 week break, he seemed to have undergone a miraculous metamorphosis. Could the family dare to hope that Tyson had turned into a likable child? It would seem the enigmatic, mysterious shifting around of horses in their stalls over the last year had stopped when Eric decided to leave them in the stalls the stranger had chosen for them. He was amazed how much more settled the horses had become, as if they liked the new arrangements so much better. Could it be that the mysterious stranger, who had shifted the horses into different stalls, had a marked understanding of animals, and had moved them so that they could be in the stalls that they personally liked best? It seemed like a crazy idea, but Eric had reached the conclusion, as the new living arrangements for the horses meant they were much more settled, and Bluebell had become infinitely less stressed. In her previous stall, Bluebell had kicked and made such a fuss, always appearing exceedingly unhappy. But now she was very contented, and the transformation in her demeanour had been nothing short of miraculous. Eric was increasingly frustrated by not knowing who had changed the stalls around for the horses, but he knew with the problem of having Tyson having moved into the Saxon household, there were bigger issues at stake than getting to the bottom of this curious mystery. How Eric wished that that dreadful woman, Rachel Carson, with her deranged, precocious brat for a kid, had not rocked up that day to upset the contented apple cart of their lives. Everything had been so blissfully peaceful, so tranquilly harmonious, until Tyson had come along, like an ugly pylon being erected in a serene area and becoming a hideous eyesore or a blight on the landscape. The kid was certainly not right in the head, and everyone who met him distanced themselves from him, almost as if they sensed he could not be trusted at all, and was bad news. Even the horses were unsettled when he was around, so Eric had kept him away from them. Eric had tried to give the young man some industrious jobs mucking stables, polishing leather tack, but he'd storm off and say, "I don't want to do that. It's boring. Why are you making me do horrible, horrible stuff? This is not fun. Why doesn't Rick have any hunting rifles? I'd like to kill some of the deer in the woodgrove. Now that would be fun. Killing things must be so much fun. Have you killed anything, Eric?" he asked, his eyes lighting up like a Christmas tree. "It's not really my sort of thing," said Eric. "But I've been on a hunt a couple of times with friends of mine. I've killed a couple of stag." "You did?" asked Tyson excitedly. "Yes, I did. Nothing too big to shout about, though." "Cool! Did the animal suffer?" Eric was horrified to see that Tyson's eyes were glimmering with hope in them, suggesting that he hoped that the animal had indeed suffered. Eric's stomach recoiled in disgust.
"No, it would not be nice, Tyson. It would be horrible to do that to an animal. It would be incredibly cruel. Hunting is not about being unkind to animals. Far from it, in fact. You can ask any hunter yourself. They might enjoy taking down a deer or something, but they never ever want an animal to suffer. And if they do cause that to happen inadvertently, they'll be very distressed about it, and immediately try to locate the animal, to end its suffering, to put it out of its misery as quickly as they can."
"Why doesn't Rick have any hunting rifles on his property?" asked Tyson indignantly.
Eric did not tell him that his father did indeed have a hunting rifle, but had locked it away for safekeeping from his own son. Eric was grievously concerned about Tyson's behaviour and the way he was so passionate about killing. He talked about it tirelessly. It gave Eric an uneasy feeling at the pit of his stomach. Much like Chelsea, Eric nursed secret worries and doubts about this child, that one day he might harm one of the family horses or do something atrociously bad to a member of the family. But he tried not to meditate over such unsavoury thoughts. The family had done everything possible to get help for Tyson, but their cries for help had fallen on deaf ears. And whenever Tyson went to see a therapist, he turned the hot tap of charm on, and Chelsea believed he made the experts think he was not as problematic as the family actually claimed he was. Since the Saxons had sent Tyson on a boys' camp for 6 weeks, the metamorphosis in his personality had been astounding on his return. Could the family dare to hope that this new Tyson was here to stay? Everyone was warming up to him. He had become approachable, hard-working, and even friendly, and he had told Chelsea that she looked very nice that morning, an unlikely compliment that had never ever crossed the threshold of the young boy's lips until now. If Tyson continued along this path, being so nice, it would be easy for Chelsea to love him like a son. If Tyson carried on being so amenable, then she'd really let her guard down and go to bed without needing to lock her bedroom door up. She had been told by the psychologist that Tyson suffered from conduct disorder and had psychopathic tendencies that would never go away. Could they have misdiagnosed him by any chance? Because the boy that left for camp was not the same boy that had returned to their farm.
It was almost as if she'd rubbed Aladdin's lamp and wished for Tyson to have a brand new heart. It was the best thing that they'd ever done, sending him off to camp. She had read the testimonials from mothers saying things like, "Before I sent my son off to camp, he was an absolute nightmare to live with. His bedroom looked like a bomb had hit it. He was always tirelessly fighting with us, telling us he wished we were all dead, and telling us how awful we were as parents. But when he returned from camp, he became polite, tidy, helpful, respectful, and even kind. Let me tell you, the military know what they're doing in shaping our children into becoming better human beings."
Other mothers had put down similar appraising comments. But maybe their kids were just normal rebellious children, whereas Tyson had been diagnosed with a very real mental condition, where he had no emotional empathy for anyone or anything. Could Tyson have been misdiagnosed by the psychologist, or was that just wishful thinking on Chelsea's part? Even her father had saliently warned her that a leopard does not change its spots. And not to place too much expectations on the camp.
"I'm sorry, Chelsea, but the camp is for only 6 weeks. And that child is big, big trouble," he had said. "I don't believe he will ever change. But you can give it a shot if you like, and hope for the best. But in my experience, miracles are very rare."
"I think you're being unnecessarily hard on the boy, Dad. Don't you think that Tyson deserves a chance?"
"I hope for your sake I am wrong about this, Chelsea," her father had said. "But I'm afraid I'd put money on the fact that that boy has not changed at all. If I was a betting man, and I was always pretty astute when I bet on the horses back in my day."
"Well, I hope you're wrong, Dad," Chelsea had said gingerly. "I really, really do. I'm so proud of you, Tyson," she told the young boy. "Ever since you've come back from the boys' camp for troubled young men, you're a different boy, aren't you? I'm very, very proud of you. Very proud. You've been so helpful around the farm, so polite and so kind towards your stepsister, Ashley. I really appreciate the efforts you're making, Tyson, to get along with the family. It's important that we all have a good time together."
For the first time in a long time, Chelsea smiled contentedly to herself as she watched Tyson take little Ashley's hand. She watched them ferreting around in the barn, bringing out their dusty bicycles, and then there they were, cycling together into the grove as if they were besties. It didn't get better than that, did it? Maybe things were going to change around the farm for the better, and the storm cloud of trepidation that had hung around their lives like a suffocating noose around the neck had finally abated, and the stress of the last 12 months faded away like the dark blue dye in a pair of denim jeans. Ashley appeared to be giggling, and there seemed a genuine warm smile on Tyson's face. He did seem such a different boy, and even Eric had said as much. Little did she know that sometimes a wolf can wear sheep's clothing, and that her daughter Ashley could potentially be in very serious danger. But for the first time in a long time, she genuinely felt her daughter was safe, until she saw Tyson returning on his bicycle, without her daughter Ashley.
"Where is my daughter?" thought Chelsea, peering out of the kitchen window, sensing something was horribly wrong. She rushed out of the kitchen door, running towards Tyson, waving a wooden spoon in her hand, sweat pouring down her flustered face. "Where is my daughter, Tyson?" she cried out. "What have you done to her?" Tyson looked at her nonchalantly.
"I think the horrible hairy man in the woods took her. He tried to hurt me too. I don't know where she's gone, but I suspect she's dead. The hairy man is very horrible."
Chelsea shook Tyson really hard. "What do you mean, hairy man took her? What hairy man? What are you talking about, Tyson? And why didn't you stop him? And what do you mean, dead? How can you say such an awful thing? You don't even seem to care. You're so cold-blooded, Tyson, you really are."
"I told you she's gone," said Tyson. You'll probably never ever see her again. She has gone.
And with that, a wicked smile developed on his face, and Chelsea thought she was going to be violently sick. She lunged towards Tyson, feeling furiously angry, slapping him across the cheek.
What did you do that for?
Said the boy, looking aggrieved. Chelsea did not respond. She ran towards the grove, her heart thundering violently in her chest. She was terrified of what she would find. She wondered privately if Tyson had done something dreadful to her daughter, and the hairy man was just a convenient excuse to get him out of trouble. What if her daughter was dead?
Please, God, no! Please, God, no!
She thought as she ran towards the grove. Eric's account. I have been working at the Saxon farmhouse since I was a teenager. The family has always paid me exceedingly generously for my services on their farm. But the Saxons are not just employers to me. They're like family, and Chelsea like an older sister. I grew up with my grandmother in town, after my mother abandoned me to embrace a career as an actress in Hollywood. But as far as I know, she's still waiting tables there, which is what actresses tend to do when they hope for that quintessential big break that seemingly never comes their way. My mother has never been in touch with me or my grandmother again. I don't know whether she's hugely embarrassed because she never made it in Hollywood, or whether she's simply not interested in being in contact with her own family. I do know that she's alive, because very recently I saw her on a background scene as an extra in a movie. As far as my father was concerned, I have no idea who he is, as my mother never revealed who he was to my grandmother. Some people would expect me to be traumatized by my mother's abandonment of me, but I have never seen it like that. She was an ambitious woman driven by a passion for her acting, and I guess I just got in her way. Some people are not cut out to be mothers, and my mother never wanted to become one, and made no secret of this fact, which is why she gladly handed me over to the charge of my grandparents. It's sad she's never been in touch, but that's sometimes the way the cookie crumbles, and I accept that. I admire her in many ways for doing the right thing by me, and realizing that motherhood was just not for her. There's nothing worse than being raised by parents that resent your intrusion in their lives. I was incredibly lucky because my grandparents loved the bones of me, so I grew up in a wholesome, very loving family home. Regretfully, my pop passed away from a stroke when I was 13 years old, so it's been pretty much me and my grandmother ever since, and we had always been very close, so I saw her as the maternal figure in my life. When I was about 14 years old or so, I began looking for odd jobs to earn a little pocket money on the side, and my grandmother actively encouraged this entrepreneurial spirit within me. I remember there was one card up on the post office wall that got my undivided attention, after I'd skimmed through dozens of others, where employers were asking to hire people to work for them in all manner of jobs, from being a groom to a caretaker, a dog walker, and you name it. Some cards were, of course, of people offering their services as a handyman, a painter or gardener. This one card seemed to literally be calling my name. It was asking for an all-round handyman that was good with horses, and it won over my heart. I knew that this was the job for me. The idea of working with horses pleased me greatly. I will openly confess to you that at the time I had absolutely no experience with horses whatsoever. But I remember thinking, what the heck? Everybody has to start somewhere, don't they? I fancied working with horses as some kind of a groomsman. For some reason, the idea appealed to me, although I had absolutely no understanding why. But that did not deter me from organizing an interview with 19-year-old Rick Saxon. I went to visit the Saxon farmhouse on the back of my bicycle, happily cycling down some of those sequestered backcountry roads, fringed by trees, as it's a heavily wooded part of the state. I remember the way that Rick Saxon first looked at me when I arrived on the scene. He looked incredibly disappointed. At the time he was living at the farmhouse with his father. The old man was sitting on the porch on an Adirondack chair smoking a tobacco pipe, staring out wistfully at the prepossessing viridescent countryside, blowing out clouds of aromatic smoke. I noticed he had Rick's sparkling hazel eyes, and when he saw me he studied me curiously, but there was a friendly twinkle in his eyes that made me warm to him at once. I had no idea what he was thinking, but this older gentleman put me at ease, while Rick, on the other hand, was so much more intense, pedantic and astute. He was focusing on finding the best man for the job, and I had this horrible gut feeling that I was not what he was looking for. So my heart sunk like a heavy stone being plunged into a body of water, but I was not ready to give up without a fight. I was invited to sit in an upholstered dining-room chair, one of eight around the stone and wood wrought-iron dinner table, where Rick and his father lightly ate their barbecue burgers on a Sunday afternoon. It was a very cosy, well-appointed wraparound porch, which had its own built-in pizza oven and a state-of-the-art barbecue grill. Rick was making notes as he interviewed me, and claimed he was seeing eight other people who were eager for the job. Whether this was true or not, I never knew. But I did know what he had written on the paper. Too young and inexperienced, not suitable. I couldn't be sure he'd written that, but it was a good guess.
I think the first question I need to ask you, Eric, is how old are you?
He asked me, looking at me through narrowing eyes. I'm 14, I said gingerly, sitting up erect and puffing out my shoulders and chest, trying to make myself appear significantly taller and larger than I actually was, which really was laughable, as I was a lanky lad at the time. But I could make myself appear older and wiser. Maybe Rick would then take me as a serious contender for this job. But my feeble efforts were a little lame. Rick almost looked at me pitifully.
I'm sorry, Eric. You are far too young. 14 years old is far too young for this job. You seem like a very nice lad, but I'm looking for someone who's had more experience than you. Have you ever worked with horses before?
I knew if I told Rick the truth that I'd never worked with horses a day in my life, I'd never even get a chance to work with horses. So I lied, which isn't exactly a good thing to do. And I hadn't been taught or raised to conduct myself in such a way. But I wanted this job so badly.
Yes, sir, I have, sir, I said brazenly. I'm very good with horses, sir.
I hastened to say, I was good with animals, but with horses, that wasn't true. I figured that I was a quick learner, and looking after horses would be a doddle for me. My 14-year-old brain did not doubt I could accomplish anything that life actually threw at me. When we're older, we so often are guilty of doubting our abilities and ourselves. But at the age of 14, I figured nothing could stand in my way. The world was my oyster.
Please give me a chance, sir. You won't regret it. I won't even charge you for the first week of my employment. I'll do everything for free. And if I'm good enough, then you can hire me. And if I'm not good enough, I'll accept my lot. But don't discriminate against me, sir, just because of my age. I'm a fast learner, really I am. And I believe I'm better than all those people you have on your list there.
At this, the corners of Rick's mouth almost twitched with amusement. He was taken aback by my confidence, but he almost said apologetically,
I'm very sorry, young man. I'm sure you're a fast learner. I appreciate your enthusiasm. Thank you very much for responding to the advert I pinned up on the post office wall. In truth, I'm really looking for someone a little older than you are, who has experience in handling horses. It's not personal. As you can see for yourself, there's a lot to do around this farm. All kinds of jobs beyond just looking after the horses. Like fixing a broken fence, clearing the paths in the grove of leaves. You can see my father here is not as young as he used to be, so he needs help.
Rick's father interjected with a glimmer of frustration in his eyes.
What my son is trying to tell you, Eric, is I'm an old man. It is true. I'm 80 years old, said Rick's father, blowing out yet more smoke from his pipe. But I can still pretty much do anything around the farm that I did when I was younger. But my son seems to think that because I'm slower than I used to be, that I need extra help around the farm. But I'm not completely redundant, you know. I cook a mean stew, and it takes me longer to get everything done, like mucking out the stables. But there's still life in these old bones yet. I'm not quite ready for the knacker's yard yet, let me tell you. Dad, don't be like that, said Rick, giving his father a frown. You said it yourself. You're 80 years old. You're allowed to slow down. And you are slower these days, so you do need help. Don't be too proud to admit it, Dad. I work in town. I need someone to manage this place while I'm away. I'm not sure at 14 years old that Eric here is capable of doing this work that needs doing around here.
He paused for a brief moment, as if another thought had suddenly occurred to him.
What about your schoolwork, Eric? I'm assuming you're at school studying, are you not? How could you possibly take on a full-time job like this at the farm, if you're studying?
Yes, I'm studying, but the work is easy. I'm homeschooled by my grandmother, you see. I'm pretty clever, always getting A's. I can do all my work when I get back home after hours, so to speak. Kill two birds with one stone. I want this job, sir, really, really badly. I promise you I'm a hard worker, and I want to help my grandmother out. She's been so good to me, sir. My pops recently died. I'm the man around the house, and I think my wages would contribute greatly to helping my grandmother out. She's given me so much. I'd like to return the favour.
And that is very nice of you indeed. You're a very thoughtful young man. But I'm sorry, son. If you were older, I would give you a chance. Ha ha! My son here talks as if he's old like me, Eric, said the old man, laughing. The truth is, he's probably only 5 years older than you are, Eric. Rick frowned. Dad, maybe at your age 5 years wasn't a big deal, but it is significant in this case. If Eric was 19 like I am, he would be more than a contender for this job. But I'm sorry, it won't work out. Besides, Eric, if you return home to your studies, I'm in no doubt you will be absolutely exhausted. I don't think you can take on a full-time job at the farm and commit yourself to your studies as well. Something's clearly got to give.
Sir, you couldn't be more wrong about that. I'm hard working. I have tons of energy. Nothing is going to give. Ask my grandmother if you don't believe me. I don't ever get tired. Please give me a chance, sir. I promise you, you won't regret your decision. I practically begged him. It was Rick's old man who came to my rescue and began to fight my corner for me, and this helpful intervention I did not expect. But with Rick's father on side, could I dare to hope that this job could potentially be mine? My heart began to do jumping jacks in my chest, and it was all I could do not to jump on the table with excited anticipation. I could practically smell this job coming my way like a juicy steak on the grill, so close to being served up to me with a portion of fries that I was eager to get my teeth into. To say that I was drooling for this job, like my grandmother drools over Toblerone chocolate from Switzerland, is an understatement to say the very least.
Son, he said to Rick, why are you being so unreasonable? You heard the boy. He's eager to work hard and to learn, and that's good enough for me. He will work for us for the first week free, he said so himself. So if you're not satisfied, you don't have to hire him. That's a very good deal, don't you think? Doesn't everybody deserve a fair shot, regardless of their age? Rick frowned. Dad, this young man is only 14. So what? Said Rick's father. When I was 14, I was doing a man's job around this farm. Very well indeed, thank you very much for your information. Give this boy a chance, Rick. He reminds me of myself when I was his age. And if he's like I was, you found yourself a trooper. Rick sighed, shaking his head vigorously, as if he'd accepted defeat. He looked from me to his father and then said, very well, I'll give you a week's trial. And if I'm not satisfied, I'm sorry, Eric, but you will have to go. Do you understand that?
That's fair, sir. That's all I could ever ask for. I understand. And I truly appreciate you giving me a chance. It means the world to me, sir. Rick slapped me on the back,
as if he was twice my age, and said, "Well, I hope I won't regret it, boy." "You won't regret it," I said, with a cheeky grin on my face that was so wide I looked like a Cheshire cat. My grandmother was amazed that I'd accepted a full-time job at the Saxon farmhouse.
"But, dear, what about your school studies?" she said, looking at me through crinkled eyes, as she moved the wool around her knitting needles with a masterful efficiency. She was making me another one of her awesome fisherman's sweaters that I loved so much, and many of the men in town ordered them from her, as they were so incredibly good.
"Better than anything you could buy from the store to lock in the warmth." "You know, Granny, I can do my studies after work. I'm hard working. I've got a ton of energy. Besides, my schoolwork is so easy." She sighed.
"Still, dear, aren't you taking on far too much for a boy your age? I thought you wanted to get yourself a part-time job. Aren't you being overly ambitious? I admire that, of course I do. But you know absolutely nothing about horses."
I grinned at her broadly. "But I'll learn. That's the point, Granny. I'll learn."
She shook her head and said,
"Where did I find you, Eric? You've got your mother's steely determination. I'll give you that. You certainly know what you want. And I admire that, Eric. I really do. But I hope you haven't bitten off more than you can chew. Dealing with a temperamental horse is no laughing matter. Believe me, I know."
"Granny, I'm going to be brilliant with horses. I feel it in my guts. I know it's the job for me."
"You know what, Eric,"
said my grandmother, giving me an amused look.
"I think you might just be right about that. I can almost see you with horses in my head. Maybe it is meant to be. Maybe it's serendipitous. Who knows? Time will tell."
Ostensibly, when I first started working at the Saxon farm, I was only equipped with my ambitious resolve to steer me over choppy waters and navigate my way seamlessly over trouble, which, believe me, in the beginning was no walk in the park. I had absolutely no experience and was a complete novice in every regard. Luckily, Rick was working in town and was not around to see me make some catastrophic mistakes that would have likely got me sacked on the very spot, and affirmed to him that his hunch was absolutely right from the very beginning, that I had no experience for this job. I was clumsy and cack-handed with some of these jobs around the farm. The old man, who asked me to call him Ray, quickly figured I'd never worked with horses before and gave me all the tips I needed to become skilled at my job, never letting his son ever find out that I'd never worked with horses a day in my life, which was good of him. That seemed to make Ray laugh all the more as he visualized his son's mortified reaction. He hooted with laughter, clutching his stomach so tightly he was getting cramps from laughing so much.
"Oh, my God," he said. "If Rick were to see the way you put the saddle on the horse, he'd be doing cartwheels and giving birth to kittens."
That seemed to make Ray laugh even more, as he visualized his son's mortified reaction at my lousy attempts to saddle a horse.
"Don't you worry, my son. Your naughty little secret is very safe with me. I will teach you all the ropes around here. And Rick will believe you were born for this job. He'll think hiring you was the very best thing the Saxon family ever did. And believe me, it will be the best thing we ever did."
"Thanks, sir. Thanks for not telling Rick about some of my big bumbles." Rick's father patted me on the back.
"Do you know, Eric, mistakes are a gift of God. No man ever accomplished anything worthwhile in life without failing first. Every setback is an opportunity to improve and to get better. Without failure, how can you ever improve?"
Rick's father taught me everything from how to ride, how to take great care of the horses, and so much more. He was such a good man and believed in my ability to do the job. And very soon even Rick had to admit I had my uses, although he did so rather begrudgingly.
I think a very small part of him hoped that I would fail exponentially, so he could say,
I told you, Dad, that this young boy was not suitable for the job.
Instead, his father Ray was the one who was able to say,
I told you, Rick, that you should have given Eric a chance. And was I right or was I right?
To which his son said,
Well, he still hasn't proved himself yet to me, Dad.
Years later, after Rick married the pregnant Chelsea and moved her into the farmhouse, I suddenly felt like I'd become part of a loving family, and Chelsea was like a big sister to me. I never looked back. And even Chelsea's daughter Ashley, when she was older, was calling me Uncle Eric, which made me feel very special. When she was christened, Chelsea had asked me to be Ashley's godfather, so I guess you could say I was an uncle to her in a manner of speaking. I would spend lackadaisical weekends with the Saxon family, and my grandmother, of course, who was often invited to join us for family barbecues and movie nights. From the moment I worked at the Saxon farmhouse from the age of 14 years old, I experienced many idiosyncratic events on the farm that made no sense to me whatsoever. They were outlandish, so much so I couldn't explain them, but I kept these things to myself. I remember on one occasion when I was clearing up one of the trails in the woodgrove, uprooting saplings from under trees that were stealing space and light, as well as hindering the growth of more mature trees. I was removing dead shrubbery on this particular occasion, but had the profound sense that I was being watched. I would not go so far as to say it creeped me out, but it was certainly very unsettling. I absolutely unequivocally knew that something was there, but I saw nothing at all. I had felt a presence in the grove, of something substantial in size, that demanded respect. I could feel an imposing energy, but I saw nothing, so it frustrated me greatly. I searched the grove, looking behind trees, but nothing was ever there. And it left me scratching my head, thinking, what the hell? Let's just say the feeling of being watched by a sizable presence had soon become an increasingly common occurrence. And after a while I got so used to the feeling, like you would get used to the sound of heavy traffic once you move close to the highway. One morning in those early days when I first started working for the Saxons and was determined to keep my job, I rocked up to work late, after Rick had left for his job in town. I'm not sure what he did at the time, but I gleaned he was not cut out for country life, although he thoroughly enjoyed its rich bounty and riding his horse Plover. I think he preferred to be stuck in a miserable little office, tackling mathematical equations. I learnt later he was working for an accounting firm. On the occasion I'd accidentally overslept and was so scared I was going to lose the job, because I was late. But to be fair, this was the first time I had been late. Everyone knows poor timekeeping can threaten your job security. I knew that in those early days, Rick was watching me like a hawk, waiting for me to trip up and hence prove I was incompetent for the job. When I arrived at work, I was panicking. I knew if I failed to put the horses out before Rick left for work, he would not be pleased with me, and my job could be hanging precariously from a fine string. When I arrived at work on the back of my bicycle, which I always left balancing against the far wall of the stable block, on this morning I found the horses had been removed from their stables and were happily grazing hay that had been put out for them. I realized at once that the old man had covered for me. I had been late on the job, and he didn't want his son to find out about my late arrival. It was like he always had my back, and I felt indebted to him for his great kindness. I told him how grateful I was that he'd taken the horses out to graze and water, and had fed them on my behalf. "I don't know what to say, sir. I'm really grateful to you." The old man looked at me and chuckled.
"What are you talking about, Eric? When Rick left for work this morning, you had watered and fed the horses yourself. They had been taken out from the stable blocks, so of course you were not late. What are you talking about, son?"
At first I thought Rick's old man was actually toying with me, to make me feel rather bad about my slip-up that morning, but I soon realized he was being deadly serious. I remember thinking, well, if Rick's father didn't let the horses out, then who did? And why would they help me like this, whoever they are? To say I was confounded is an understatement, but someone or something had my back and was looking out for me.
It was during the summer months I was always looking for pawpaws in the woodgrove, as they grow abundantly here in the Bluegrass State, because the soil is very rich, and they're easy to find. My grandmother loved pawpaws. There was always a bountiful supply of pawpaw trees in the Saxon woodgrove. They'd pop up out of nowhere with a dogged determination. The pawpaws were superbly sweet. I took my bicycle with its basket and cycled down the earthen trails in the grove. I could see some ripe pawpaws growing on a lofty tree, but I couldn't reach them, which was exceedingly frustrating. I tried everything, including a long piece of timber to remove the ripe fruit, but I still could not reach it. Of course I could have shaken the tree and brought down the fruit, but there were some green pawpaws that still needed to ripen. So if I shook the tree, I'd bring down the unripe fruit as well, and those pawpaws were far too green to ripen in a fruit bowl. I decided to look for another pawpaw tree. I walked on foot searching for another tree, and I found one soon enough. I managed to pick a ripe pawpaw that was still a little on the greenish side, but it would soon ripen in a fruit bowl. I returned to my bicycle, and there in my bicycle basket were the two orange pawpaws, the very same ones I'd tried to bring down on my own accord. I noticed they were now missing from the tree. But what were they doing in my basket? Who had put them there? Was someone playing tricks on me? I asked Rick's father about the matter, and when I told him about it, he chuckled and said, "Maybe the hairy man helped you out. He's a very nice fellow, he is." I had no idea what on earth he was talking about. "What hairy man?" I asked him. And then he shut me down and said, "Never you mind. You'll find out soon enough." And then he said it was obvious that the hairy man liked me. "You're lucky to have him on side," he said. I thought Rick's father, with advancing age, must be getting slightly delusional. He often claimed he'd lost his glasses when he was actually wearing them on his head. So I took his ruminations about a hairy man with a pinch of salt. But so many things happened over the years that were hard to explain. But it almost certainly seemed as if someone was always lending a helping hand. I do vividly recall the very day that Rick's father tragically dropped down dead from a heart attack at his home, almost as if it happened yesterday. I was fond of the old man, and seen his increasing forgetfulness as rather endearing. On one occasion he lost his car keys, and found them in the freezer. Another time he put his sandwiches that I'd made him for lunch in the drum of the washing machine, which I found hilariously funny. Rick always asked me to keep an eye on his father for me, and to help him out making him coffee and sandwiches for lunch. Sometimes I'd play cards with Ray, and keep a cosy fire crackling away merrily in the hearth during the winter months. These were the good old days before Rick and Chelsea were a couple. I remember I was taking Peregrine, one of the black and bay American quarter horses, for a ride in the grove. Rick believed it was significantly important to ride the horses regularly, to keep them healthy and fit. It was a job I thoroughly enjoyed doing, and thanks to Rick's father, I had become an accomplished rider. I was trotting down the horse-riding trail, and then in a trice, like a bolt of lightning, a very clear voice in my head, that was not my own, told me I needed to get back to the farmhouse at once. I didn't hesitate to obey the voice. I galloped straight back to the farmhouse and immediately checked on the welfare of Rick's father. I think I had a profound instinctive sense that something was terribly wrong. The man was 84 years old. He was on medications for his heart and blood thinners. I noticed he was peacefully lying slumped back on a lounger chair on the wraparound porch, seemingly blissfully soaking up the morning sun, which he did religiously every morning as a matter of routine. I noticed Ray's mouth was wide open, his eyes tightly closed. He looked as if he was sleeping, but on his body was a large arrangement of wild flowers, and there was a pretty stone placed on his head in a strategic position that some people choose to call the third eye. It was the most outlandishly bizarre thing that I have ever beheld. I tried to wake Ray up, but he was out cold. He had no pulse. He was beyond being revived by CPR. I could see he was dead, but he looked very peaceful. The coroner concluded that his death was a natural death and would have been instant for him. When Rick arrived on the scene, he gave me a funny look. I realized he thought it was rather strange of me,
that I'd placed wild flowers all over his father's body.
It was very thoughtful of you to do. It's very kind of you, Eric, he said soberly, but the flowers you picked from the meadow cannot go with my father in the coroner's van. But not to worry, son, he assured me. You can lay down some fresh flowers for him when he gets buried at his gravesite.
He then removed the stone from his father's head, giving me another rather peculiar look. I guess he thought it was profoundly odd that I appeared to have decorated his father's deceased corpse.
I don't think we'll be needing this, he said, handing me the stone,
which was warm to the touch. I felt rather silly, but I never told Rick it wasn't me who'd covered his dad with a bouquet of flowers. But I will never forget his nonplussed look, and looking back, it was hilariously funny. Then there was the mystery of the stalls being changed for the horses. I soon decided the horses preferred this new arrangement. They seemed so much more settled, a little like children in a large house, deciding which bedroom suited them the best. It seemed the horses were happier with their new living arrangements. I'll never forget the day that I was sitting in the kitchen with Chelsea, enjoying coffee and toast, telling her about this profoundly baffling mystery with the horses, when that annoying woman, Rachel Carson, arrived on the scene in her car. It was unsettling when she pulled out a hefty suitcase on wheels from her white Dodge Ranger, along with a truculent 11-year-old boy, who was obviously her son. The moment she barged into the farmhouse with an impertinent presumptuousness, I knew this woman was bad news. It turned out my gut instincts were right on the money. Let's just say she unleashed an explosive bomb on us when she announced that Rick was the father of her child. I will admit I was incredibly surprised. Rick is the salt of the earth, never been a ladies' man. He's only had less than a handful of girlfriends in his entire life. This woman's startling revelations were a turn-up for the books. But she claimed that although she had known Rick when she was little, that at 18 years old, she and Rick had had a one-night stand together, when he was half-cut. Personally, I was not remotely surprised that Rick had refused to marry this obnoxious woman. She was profoundly odd, the kind of person most men, if they were wise, would give a wide berth. On her you could smell trouble. She was bad news, announcing she was leaving her son Tyson at the farmhouse to be raised by Rick and Chelsea. She wanted to abandon her parental responsibility as sole carer for her son, and it became clear that she couldn't cope with her juvenile delinquent, so why not pass him on to us? From the very beginning, Tyson was trouble. The year he spent at the Saxon farmhouse had been a very challenging year indeed. The kid had a fixation for hunting, but not in a healthy way, let me assure you. He asked me all kind of questions about what it was like to kill. He couldn't comprehend that hunters did not get a macabre satisfaction from causing an animal to suffer. I told him the idea of hunting was, of course, for sport, but usually to cull an overpopulated herd, to keep numbers more manageable, to acquire game meat and skins, but never ever about suffering. And the child did not get that. He thought a hunter wanted to watch something die an agonizingly cruel, slow, painful death, and get some kind of morbid, grotesque satisfaction from this process. And that was very disturbing to me, to see a young boy talking in this disquieting way, without so much as batting an eyelid. I expressed my misgivings to Chelsea, who took on board my concerns. I remember when Chelsea sent Tyson off to the 6-week military camp for troubled children called Transformative Kids or something like that, run by 2 retired army officers. I knew that the 12-year-old had not changed at all. When he returned to the farm, I think he just became more cunningly manipulative, duplicitous and Machiavellian, and was cleverly masking the fact that he had not changed at all. I privately suspected that Tyson, who had recently turned 12, had not changed at all. I think he'd become more cunningly manipulative, Machiavellian and duplicitous, and was masking it well. He hadn't changed at all. I privately concluded he was the same troubled boy.
"Tyson is so different, isn't he?" Chelsea told me. "I think he's a new man. I really do. It seems 6 weeks under a military regime
has knocked our boy into shape. Isn't this wonderful news? I was not so sure that this was the case. I was exceedingly skeptical. I could see that Chelsea was so upbeat, so happy about the kid's apparent miraculous transformation. I didn't want to put a damper in the works, but I did warn her to be careful and mindful that 6 weeks could not change the character of a person or rehabilitate them.
I think he does appear different. I really do, Eric, Chelsea insisted.
I still think you should be on guard, Chelsea, because only time will tell if this is indeed the case.
You're so skeptical, Eric. You really are, she teased. You're just like my father, who says a leopard can't change his spots. Give the young boy a break, won't you? He's trying very hard to reform himself. He really has turned over a new leaf. I think you should give him credit for that. We need to encourage him to become a better person, not to doubt him all the time. You should give him the benefit of the doubt, Eric.
It was as I was mucking up the stables. I looked up to see 12-year-old Tyson and 9-year-old Ashley riding into the grove together on their bicycles. This was a turn-up for the books. Ashley had never trusted her stepbrother one bit, and expressed her misgivings about Tyson, as he was always teasing her, bullying her, patronizing her, or poking fun at her.
"I don't like Tyson," she would say. "He's always horrible to me, and when you're not looking, he pulls my hair and pinches me really, really hard. He pushed me over so many times. He hurt me."
This was indeed true. Chelsea was always reprimanding Tyson for hurting his stepsister. But the more she scolded him, the more he enjoyed hurting his sister, as if upsetting Chelsea gave him an insidious sense of satisfaction. On this occasion it appeared that little Ashley had whimsically blown all caution to the wind, and much like her mother Chelsea, was buying into the fact that Tyson had changed exponentially into a whole new boy, and now Ashley profoundly believed she had a new brother that she could play with, who was not intent on hurting her. She was eager now to spend time with him, as if she'd found for herself a brand new playmate. I had witnessed Tyson pulling Ashley's hair and taking pleasure from hurting her too many times to count. Why should things have suddenly changed? He had loved it when she screamed out in pain. It had made my skin crawl to see how his face would light up like a Christmas tree when he was being cruel to his stepsister. He was a depraved young boy, and my hopes of him ever redeeming himself were pretty slim. I was not remotely convinced that Tyson had changed at all, and exhibited a healthy scepticism about miraculous transformations of any kind that I rarely ever saw in the natural world, so why should I see them in human beings, least of all a belligerent, capricious little boy, who'd only been a source of great contention for the family since he'd moved into the Saxon household. I immediately abandoned my job at hand, clandestinely following the kids into the grove. I had to run reasonably fast to keep up with them, but I was as fit as a fiddle, so it was no biggie keeping up to their pace. But I didn't want them to know that I was stalking them, as kids hate it when adults spy on them. I was determined to keep a stealthy eye on Ashley and her stepbrother, see how they were interacting together, because I knew that this young man had not changed, and I was concerned about what would actually happen. Why was Chelsea so quick to trust the so-called new Tyson, based on the dramatic improved behaviour she was seeing, supposing she was wrong about him? It was a beautiful day. Spring had seized a strong hold over the bluegrass state, holding winter to ransom, like a police officer cuffing a truculent young offender. The once naked boughs of the trees had been stripped of their former resplendence. They were now covered in a pretty display of fresh leaves. The dogwoods, saucer magnolias and cherry blossoms, were covered in ethereal blossoms, splashing their bouquet of pastel colours over the grove with a proud elegance. It was a perfectly blissful day, the sky a cup of blue, and it merrily peeked through the boughs of the trees, bespeckling the forest floor in a twinkling golden glaze. The woodgrove was furnished in patches of daffodils, bluebells, ferns, forest shrubbery, and shade-loving flowers. When the two children reached the creek in the woods, covered with a pretty little bridge that Rick's father had erected a while back, they propped their bicycles up against a couple of oak trees. Ashley pulled out a piece of chalk from a pocket in her blue jeans. She drew something on the wooden decking of the bridge. The two kids were happily playing hopscotch together, while the water in the creek gurgled beneath their feet. When I watched them together, I felt profoundly silly. Maybe I was wrong, and that Tyson really was a reformed character, and I had been overreacting. Ashley began to look up at Tyson, as if she genuinely believed he'd morphed into her big stepbrother that she was proud of.
"You're so different, Tyson. I like you now. You used to be horrible, doing bad things to me, like pulling my hair really hard. And then there was the time that you shredded my brand new school uniform into lots and lots of pieces. Why did you do that?"
"'Cause your mother brought you new stuff, but she didn't want to buy me sneakers. It wasn't fair."
"But you didn't have to have fancy sneakers, did you?" said Ashley, looking perplexed. "I had to have a new school uniform because I grew out of my old one. So I had to have a new one." "Your mother was always showing you favouritism," insisted Tyson, sounding piqued at the mere memory of the event, it would seem. "Your mum favours you over me. It stinks. She never liked me." "But why do you get so mad? Especially that time when Mummy wouldn't give you an extra helping of Mississippi mud pie. I thought you would hit Mummy really hard because you looked really, really angry. Your skin turned blue. Your jaws were grinding."
"I told you, your mum was not being fair. She's never fair. I don't like your mother. She didn't want me to have another slice of pie. She's always mean like that."
"But she didn't give me an extra piece of mud pie either. She says it isn't good for us to have too many pieces. It's way too much sugar. She doesn't want us to get fat." "Who's she to decide what's good for me? I'd never get fat anyway. Look how skinny I am," said Tyson, tapping his flat stomach to emphasize a point. It was true. He was a skinny boy.
"I know, but if you eat like a pot-bellied pig, you'll become one day. That's what Mummy says."
"Your Mummy doesn't know anything. She thinks she knows everything, but she knows nothing. She thinks she's clever, but she's stupid."
"Mummy's not stupid. She sent you to that place and you're not horrible anymore, so she did a clever thing. What was the place that Mummy and Daddy sent you to like? Was it nice where you went?"
Tyson pulled a face.
"It was horrible," he said. "I'm told it's like being in the army. I'm never ever going to the army when I grow up. Not if that's what it's like."
"Are you upset that Mum sent you there?"
"Of course I'm upset. It's a horrible, horrible place. Any time we did anything wrong, we had to do hundreds of press-ups. It sucked."
I felt genuinely bad eavesdropping on these children's conversation, like a predatory stalker. I watched as both Ashley and Tyson sat at the edge of the creek, after they'd played hopscotch together. Tyson told his sister he was going to braid her hair very nicely for her.
"But I don't like anybody playing with my hair except Mummy."
"Please, I'll look after your hair very nicely. I'll make it pretty."
"All right then, but you've got to make it really pretty," said Ashley, "so I can show Mummy what you've done."
While all this was happening, I was certain I'd seen a lofty, ambiguous, dark shadow in the trees, as if I was not the only one watching these children, but someone else was keeping a beady eye on them too. I told myself I was being absolutely ridiculous. What I had seen was just a trick of the light. The woodgrove was always casting dark shadows due to the light in the woodgrove intermingling with the shade, which can play tricks with your imagination,
and make you falsely believe you're seeing things that are not really there. I watched Tyson braiding his sister's hair, and Ashley seemed to enjoy having her hair tugged by him. Tyson began fiddling in the pocket of his jeans. He removed something stealthily from his pocket. It looked like something white. At first I wasn't sure what it was. I saw Tyson do the most unthinkable thing. I froze to the spot when he pulled out a plastic bag from his pocket and placed it on his sister's head, tying it in a knot so it couldn't easily be removed. Ashley jumped up and began to scream, desperately trying to remove the plastic from her head. But Tyson quickly grabbed her, restraining her arms with an old tie, and tying her up so that Ashley could not remove the bag from her head that was suffocating her so that she failed to breathe. I was absolutely mortified by what I was seeing. For a moment I froze to the spot, going as cold and as frozen as a block of ice, as I tried to assimilate what I was actually observing. Tyson was insanely evil. He was wickedly delighting in seeing his poor stepsister in such a sorry state. Ashley was frantically running around the grove with her hands tied behind her back, desperately trying to remove the plastic bag from her head, like a headless chicken. Tyson began clapping his hands in delight and laughing at her expense.
"You look so funny! It's hilarious to see you like this! You're going to go to heaven, sis, so don't fight it! I'm going to get all the attention from your mother from now on!"
I'd like to say I ran over to Ashley to rescue her, but someone else came to the rescue, whose response was faster and quicker than my own. I saw this huge, black, giant-like figure, shaped like a man, covered in hair, thundering through the trees. He immediately pulled the plastic bag off Ashley's head. She gasped for breath, falling onto her knees, heaving and wheezing. The titanic-sized hair-covered creature that I later discovered from my research was a Bigfoot, lunged towards Tyson, grabbing him by the scruff of his collar, lifting him up so that his head was in line with the Bigfoot's eyes. I got the sense that some kind of telepathic communication was being exchanged between the two of them, almost as if the Bigfoot had given him a huge telling off. The Bigfoot roared. Tyson looked like a puppet in his hands. The Bigfoot screamed, swinging his arms around so threateningly that even as a bystander, I almost fainted with terror. I unequivocally believed that the enraged Bigfoot, who was practically spitting bile at Tyson like a python, was going to kill the young boy. Tyson's eyes were terrified. They were as round as saucers, and he was crying as he dangled from the Bigfoot's arm like a puppet on a string. He begged to be put down by the creature.
"Please don't hurt me! Don't hurt me! Don't hurt me! Put me down! Put me down! Put me down!"
This was the first time I'd ever seen Tyson crying. The Bigfoot tossed Tyson on the ground with an expression of disgust on his face, as if he was throwing out a filthy, stinking baby's diaper. I was watching the sequence of events unfold, as if it was a movie. The Bigfoot was staring directly at Tyson as he got back to his feet and hobbled over to his bicycle. He looked as if he was trying to appease the family cat, not to lash out at him, although in this case the cat in question was more like a lion, as the Bigfoot was gargantuan in size. I've never seen Tyson so afraid before. He feared for his life as he cycled out of the grove, as fast as the wind on a stormy day. Ostensibly, he gave no regard at this point in time for the safety of his stepsister, who moments before he had tried to kill. The young boy falsely concluded that this hairy man was going to harm little Ashley, even though it was the Bigfoot that had saved the day by removing the bag from Ashley's head. What happened next amazed me, leaving me completely speechless and confounded. The Bigfoot took little Ashley's hands in his large hand. He led her towards the tree where I was hiding. How did he even know I was there? I found myself looking up into the eyes of a 9-foot-tall Bigfoot. He had kind, treacle-colour eyes. I heard a voice in my head. The same telepathic voice I'd heard when I was told to go back to the farmhouse when Rick's father had died.
You need to take her back to safety. That young boy is dangerous. You must deal with him severely. I would have done so myself, but it's the parents' responsibility to discipline their children, and not mine.
And with that, the Bigfoot simply glided away. It was Ashley's near-death experience that finally made the authorities take notice, and after many mental evaluations, Tyson was put away in a mental facility, where the top psychologist, a man called Dr. Von Straten, claimed he should never be let out, as he was deemed a danger to society, as conduct disorder in kids is often referred to as antisocial personality disorder in adults. But it was clear that Tyson was a psychopath who didn't know the meaning of the word compassion and only cared about one person, and that was himself. The psychologist explained that he also possessed feelings of grandiosity and superiority, believing he was profoundly better and cleverer than anybody else. Chelsea did go and visit Tyson at the psychiatric facility to ask him why he had done such a wicked thing to his stepsister. He had gormlessly grinned at her and said he'd wanted her to die, and that he'd been fantasizing about killing her for a long time. He explained that if Ashley was out of the way, he'd have received more attention. The strangest thing of all was he had absolutely no memory of the Bigfoot. It was as if that memory had been wiped out of his mind. Chelsea was appalled and confided in me that Tyson had told her in no uncertain terms that if he ever got out, he'd find her and kill the entire family.
"Don't worry," I assured her. "He'll never ever get out. You heard the psychologist. Tyson is considered a threat to society."
Chelsea thought her daughter would be traumatized by the event in the Woodgrove, but she also had no memory of the event at all. And in the years that followed, she completely forgot that she even had a stepbrother called Tyson. Chelsea perceived she had chosen to block the trauma from her life and thought better about bringing the topic up for discussion ever again. 22 years later. It had been a magnificently beautiful summer's day in the Bluegrass State, and a tired spring had released her final yawn, and summer had taken over the reins. But because it was still early summer, the weather was pretty close to perfect. It was not too hot, nor too cool. The countryside was spectacular, with vivid green pastures and woodgroves ablaze with green leafy boughs. Chelsea had met up with her daughter Ashley in town to go shopping with her and to enjoy lunch together. These days they were the very best of friends. Ashley lived locally in town and was currently unmarried, but she had an apartment of her own and was a successful manageress to an up-and-coming restaurant run by an illustrious chef that was all the rage. People from out of state visited the town for a culinary experience. The chef was a local boy who started up his own restaurant and was having the most marvellous write-ups in the New York Times and other prominent newspapers. Chelsea would have liked her daughter to settle down, but after a string of disastrous relationships, Ashley had decided to put relationships on the back burner.
"I just so wish, sweetheart, that you'd go out more, meet more people. I'd like to see you settling down, finding yourself a very nice man. Me and your father would like to have grandchildren one day. Your father is longing to become a granddad."
"Ma'am, the trouble with you is you're a hopeless romantic. And for your information, I do actually meet lots of people at the restaurant when I show them to their tables. They come from all over the place to visit our restaurant."
"Yes, but that's not the perfect way to meet people, love."
"I'm not going on a dating site, Mum, if that's what you're suggesting. If I'm meant to meet someone, I will. It'll happen. I'm old-fashioned that way."
Ashley had returned home, feeling sad that her daughter was still single. She had clandestine dreams of becoming a grandmother one day. But if Ashley never met the right gentleman, she might never become a grandmother. And that thought did not sit terribly well with her. When Ashley finally returned to the Saxon farmhouse, Eric met her with a broad grin on his face, as he always did. Nothing had changed in that regard. and Eric was as handsome as ever. He'd come over to the farmhouse to join her for some tea, and of course to inquire after his goddaughter Ashley. Eric was now happily married, and was living in his grandmother's house, which she had bequeathed him after she'd passed away 10 years earlier. He still had never heard from his mother all these years later, but suspected she was still very much alive, and that if she really wanted to get hold of him, she'd have only had to look him up. Eric still managed the affairs of the farm, and also taught horse-riding lessons to people who wanted to learn how to ride. He did this on the Saxon property, and the business paid him well. Furthermore, he loved what he did, and Rick Saxon, who was earning a sizable income at his accounting firm, paid Eric handsomely. Eric had 2 young children, and loved being a father.
"So tell me, Chelsea, how was your lunch today with Ashley?" asked Eric, nursing his coffee. "Well, she was in good spirits. She's run into the ground, of course, in that fancy restaurant. I believe the chef has a James Beard Award already." "Well, that is incredible," said Eric, looking impressed. "Well, the food there is absolutely fabulous. The chef is brilliant. Such a nice young man. He only uses the freshest high-quality produce for his menus. He says if you cook with inferior produce, you get lousy results. It doesn't matter how good a cook you are." "What is wrong, Chelsea?" said Eric, reaching out to give her a squeeze. "You look, what's the word? A little, how do I put it? Sorrowful, perhaps." Chelsea shrugged her shoulders sadly. "I'm an open book to you, aren't I, Eric? Nothing ever passes your beady eyes. If you must know, it's Ashley. She's getting a lot older." "Yes, so what about it?" "Well, there's no significant other in her life, is there?" "Is that such a bad thing? Is that all you're worried about?" "Of course it's a bad thing, Eric. How will I ever get to be a grandmother if she never meets anyone? Do you know, I think she believes in serendipity. Sometimes even serendipity needs a bit of a push, and I'm thinking of being the one to do it." "Well, I also happen to believe in serendipity. How do you think I met my wife? Can you ever imagine me advertising myself on a dating site? That would never happen. I've got no patience for things like that. Besides, I'm far too introverted. If I didn't meet someone serendipitously, I'd have never met anyone at all."
"So then how did you meet Veronica?" asked Chelsea. "You never actually told me how you two met."
"As I was telling you, Chelsea, it was serendipitous. There's no other word for it," said Eric, grinning cheekily. "Some things are just meant to be. I believe that emphatically. So don't be so hard on Ashley. Give her time. She'll meet the right man eventually."
"Convince me of that, Eric. How on earth did you meet Veronica? You haven't answered my question yet, and I'm sitting here on tender hooks. I need to know the details."
"Well, I met her in the pet shop in town, didn't I? She was buying goldfish, would you believe? I've kept a goldfish tank for many years in my grandmother's house. It was clear that Veronica was clueless about goldfish. She was standing there in the queue with a large bag of goldfish in her hand. I think there were about 6 in there. I was looking at the fish, telling her that one of them was not going to make it. She selected a sick one that was practically dying there in the, you know, plastic container that it was in. I told her she should never buy it. It turned out she was a novice at looking after fish, had no idea what she was doing, even though she'd purchased a fish tank for herself, and was not sure how to get the whole thing started. So I said I would give her a helping hand." "Oh, you old rogue, Eric! I bet you did. My word! You're so eager to help when you can, Eric." "Well, I was in this set of circumstances. Very happy to meet Veronica, I was. It was serendipitous. There's no other word for it.
If I hadn't been in the pet shop at that time, I would never have met her.
Well, what were you doing there in the first place? Please don't tell me you followed her sneakily into the pet shop. Is that what you did, Eric? Own up, admit it to me.
I will admit nothing of the sort. If I had seen her going into the pet shop to buy goldfish, I probably would have followed her in, because I was very, very enamoured by her. There was something about her that got my attention. But the reason I actually went into the pet shop was because I was buying bird seed for our wild birds at home. I have a bird table outside the kitchen window. I also hang a nectar bottle out on a tree. I love to watch the birds drinking the nectar, eating the seed. It's a very pleasing sight. Nothing more pleasing than watching your garden birds.
So you think that I should just rely on serendipity for my daughter to meet Mr. Wright? Is that what you're saying, Eric?
Absolutely. Don't get involved, Chelsea. It'll happen. I promise you it will. Oh, by the way, I forgot to mention that some post came for you this morning. It's an official-looking letter from that psychiatric facility where Tyson was being held.
You have got to be kidding me, said Chelsea, growing as white as a piece of paper.
I'm sorry I'm not. I wish I was, said Eric. But don't you worry, Chelsea, I'm here. Just read it and see what it has to say.
Eric brought over the letter for Chelsea to read. She began fingering it in her hands apprehensively, terrified about opening the envelope.
Open it up, Chelsea, or do you want me to do it for you? Said Eric, his face registering concern.
It's all right, Eric. I'll open it up, said Chelsea. I'm a big girl now. Of course I can do it.
Eric watched Chelsea open the letter very reluctantly. She flung it onto the table, throwing her arms over her head in frustration, and looking at Eric through wide eyes, dappled with fear.
No! No! This can't be happening, Eric!
What's the problem? Asked Eric. You're scaring me, Chelsea. What the hell is wrong?
It's Tyson. He's getting out of that psychiatric hospital. It says here he's deemed safe to live in society now. I've appealed against him getting out. And although he's not allowed to come near our property, there's no guarantee that he won't. You know what he said to me all those years ago, when I visited him at the psychiatric facility. He said, Eric, he was going to come after my family and kill us all. The psychologist who would not let him see the light of day is apparently now dead. This is a dreadful, dreadful nightmare.
Tears bounded down Chelsea's cheeks. She began to sob uncontrollably.
I'm scared, Eric. Really scared. What if we're all in danger? It's a real possibility. Forget about being a grandmother. I might not live to ever see another day.
Chelsea, listen to me, will you? Don't get so distraught about all of this. When Tyson told you he'd come and kill you after he got out of that juvenile psychiatric facility, he was 12 years old at the time, and a troubled boy at that. Remember you sent him to that rehabilitation camp for young boys who had big issues, run by 2 military men, for 6 weeks, I believe it was. He never forgave you for that. But people change and don't act out on their threats. He's a grown man now, a young man. I'm sure he's matured significantly and has had a great deal of therapy to address his problems. What he said back then, Chelsea, probably carries no weight now. Besides, he's been mentally evaluated, has he not? By highly qualified, skilled professionals who've deemed him safe enough to enter society. And those proficient experts must know exactly what they're talking about.
But have you forgotten what he did all those years ago to our Ashley, when you yourself witnessed him putting a plastic bag over her head? Do you know, I don't think she has any memory of that traumatic event.
And thank God for that. But I don't believe he's changed, Eric. I really don't. You didn't believe he'd changed when he came back from that transformative camp. And that's why you clandestinely followed him into the grove. And your instincts were dead right. The rest of us were completely hoodwinked by his Machiavellian duplicity. But no, not you, Eric. Why are you choosing to change your mind about him now?
I'm not changing my mind about him, Chelsea. Far from it, in fact. But I do happen to have respect for psychologists that have been evaluating your stepson. Maybe he's not a danger anymore. Perhaps he's had the necessary therapies and medications that have deemed him safe, suppressed that side of his character that predisposes him to becoming aggressive. Besides, he's not permitted to go near your property, and I doubt he'd compromise his freedom by breaking the rules. He'd have to go straight back to the facility, and he doesn't want that. He's not stupid. And I think beyond anything else, medical health care has come along in leaps and bounds in recent years. Tyson, for all you know, could be a changed young man.
You think that medical health care has advanced in recent years? I don't think so, said Chelsea, looking sceptical. And as far as Tyson being a transformed man, I very much doubt it. Despite Eric's reassurances, Chelsea was not remotely convinced that Tyson was not a threat to her life. She could still see the cocky look on his face and the menacious grin from all those years ago when he looked at her and said,
"When I get out, I'm coming for you, and don't believe I won't. You've been warned."
2 weeks later, how Chelsea wished with all her heart that she was not at home alone. She had surreptitiously hidden her rising, grievous concerns about Tyson from the rest of her family. Her husband Rick was out of state visiting relatives, and she had actively encouraged him to go. She didn't want to be nannied by her husband, based on fears that may indeed be unfounded. But were they? It was the knowing that Tyson was out of the psychiatric facility that had left her perpetually uneasy, with a feeling of impending dread hanging over her like a hangman's noose. Unfortunately, Rick was of the mindset that the family would never ever cross paths with Tyson again. But Chelsea, no, Chelsea was not so sure about that. She knew that, like many fungal infections, like athlete's foot, for example, things can have a nasty habit of making an unwelcome reappearance in your life. The Tysons of this world did not just vaporize into thin air. She was sure of that. She believed he'd be back like an odorous bad smell. But the question was when, and if. But she was sure the if didn't count at all. It was only a question of when. She was forever looking over her shoulders to check she was not being followed. And these days, since the news that Tyson was now a free man, she was suffering from increasing paranoia, making absolutely certain that every door was double-bolted at night. She was also considering getting an alarm installed, but the alarm man had not visited the house yet, and whether that would help or not, she wasn't certain. It was after a fitful sleep during the night, broken by intervals of restlessness, when sleep cruelly eluded her, that Chelsea jumped up from her bed with a start, wiping the residue of sleep from her eyes. She was sure she'd heard a car rolling down the driveway, and her heart froze in her chest like a large lump of ice. She gingerly, rather cautiously, crept over to the bedroom window, twitching the curtains, peering out between the crack in the fabric, her fingers gripping the material so tightly that her knuckles glared out of her skin like beacons of light. It was dark outside, with a sky an inky black colour. She realised there was a lonesome car squatting inauspiciously on her driveway, its lights illuminating the courtyard and triggering the motion-activated outdoor lights to come on, so that Chelsea could see everything very clearly. The engine rumbled. It stuttered into a death rattle until it quivered into a silent yawn. while the passenger remained seated in the front seat of the car. Everything became chillingly quiet. Chelsea's heart vibrated into life from its catatonic state. It began to boom through her chest as if hundreds of galloping stallions were bolting right through her at the speed of light. Chelsea drew in a deep, anxious breath, terribly afraid that the treacherous sound her breathing made could be heard by the unwelcome stranger, seated in the front seat of his car in the middle of the night, like an unexploded bomb that was about to go off. The man's ominous presence certainly had blown all Chelsea's confidence into flying pieces of shrapnel. Her body rattled like the freestanding glasses in a bar, and even her bones began to quiver and quake like the old rickety floorboards in a mansion. She was certain she had not been seen. She tiptoed cautiously in the dark, with only a whisper of light trickling through the bedroom from the night light on the landing. Chelsea remained on tenterhooks, motionlessly watching and waiting for something to happen. She anchored herself to the curtains, like the large white sails of a boat, and stole sneaking glances at the car from a tiny crack in the fabric. The cloying silence continued. It cloaked her in a blanket of trepidation. The red and black car in the driveway seemed harmlessly benign. It remained stoically still, unflinching, like a dead, oversized ladybug lying across the asphalt. She could have been forgiven for thinking there was no one in that car, but she knew better. She could see the vague human silhouette, the shape of a head, shoulders, and a pair of hands, casually resting on a steering wheel. And then she could see a whisper of smoke spilling out of a small opening in the driver's side window, which suggested the driver was enjoying a smoke, taking his time while she hyperventilated in the house, like a trapped insect in a bottle. She observed a hand moving away from the steering wheel. She jerked her head forward to get a better look at what the stranger was actually doing. Every hair on the back of her neck was standing on end. She began to open and close her hands into a fist. The nervousness within her grew wings. She became restless and began pacing up and down the bedroom, like a lion at a zoo. She ran her hand through her hair in exasperation, trying desperately to think, but her thoughts seemed to just flee away from her. She sat back on her mattress, staring out in the gloomy, oppressive darkness, with an almost resigned, hopeless acceptance, like a mouse cornered in a small space by the family tabby, knowing in moments it'll likely be eaten alive. Chelsea felt almost as if there was no escape. Why not just surrender to her impending fate? Just give up. What was she expected to do? She kept telling herself to think. She knew what was out there, waiting patiently in that car. She had predicted this would happen. She had smelt this eventuality, like a fox on the trail of a rabbit, from a long way off. No one had paid attention to her concerns about Tyson acting out on his threats. But they had not been there the day when Tyson's steely eyes had widened, as he'd stared at her fiercely, after having executed a lethal threat that had clung to her for over 22 years, with the tenacity of chewing gum under a classroom desk that could never be shifted. She anticipated that that car on her driveway, like a weather reporter on the evening news, might predict the advent of snow over the Christmas season. She knew that this day would come, and here it was. She had seen this vividly in her head. How could her husband and Eric be so naive? How could they believe a young man like Tyson, who felt he'd been cruelly wronged, locked up in a psychiatric facility for so long, not choose to come after them to wreak his revenge on them? By all accounts, Tyson had exhibited hostile feelings towards Chelsea in that Anna Cerebilis insufferable year when he'd moved into the Saxon household. He had believed she bestowed extreme favouritism on Ashley, her daughter, and had never forgiven her for that. Chelsea would have gladly been a great mother towards Tyson, if only he'd allowed her the privilege. But it's hard to make friends with a belligerent crocodile that would gladly bite off your hand if given half the chance. Tyson had been an objectionable, obnoxious boy, and loving him had been close to impossible. But she had tried her hardest to do just that. The Saxons had walked on eggshells to appease the truculent boy, but Tyson had remained resolutely unpleasant to have around, and had delighted in spreading unease wherever he went, like rancid butter over mouldy bread. It had been the most magnificent day of their lives to see him being handcuffed and placed in the back of a police vehicle, and driven far away from their home and their lives. It was on that auspicious day. The air had felt so fragrant and fresh. The whole countryside had smiled more brightly. The coldness of the entire year had thawed, and everything was vividly brighter, sharper, infinitely more beautiful than ever before. The frolicking horses and spirited dogs seemed infinitely more upbeat. In the grand scheme of things, it was devastatingly tragic that the family's cries for help had never been taken seriously. It had actually taken a bag over Ashley's head to make the authorities sit up and finally take notice, to recognise that Tyson was indeed a dangerous boy. Chelsea could never forget the delighted smirk on Tyson's face. It still haunted her life all these years later, when he'd rocketed through the woodgrove on his bicycle, looking at first alarmed, visibly shaken, and then finally a smug sort of satisfaction had crept over his face. When she'd asked him where Ashley was, he'd told her with a pleased smirk that her daughter would never, ever be coming back home. He had said this with a resolute finality, that Ashley was certain that he'd actually killed her daughter. And in that ominous second, she realised that Tyson had not changed at all. She had run over to him, shaken him vigorously hard.
"What have you done to my daughter? What have you done? What have you done?"
"I told you, she's not coming back. She's taken by a big hairy man. I think he took her. I believe she's dead. He probably killed her. I'm lucky I got away from him."
Ashley's face had gone as white as paper. She continued to shake Tyson.
"What have you done? You killed my daughter. Have you killed my daughter?"
"I wanted to," he grinned, "but somebody else finished the job for me."
Chelsea ran frantically towards the grove to find her daughter, but Ashley had appeared. She had been walking through the trees, holding Eric's hand. Chelsea's heart had skipped with relief. She ran ebulliently towards Ashley, swaddling her lovingly in her arms.
"I thought you were dead," she had wept.
Ashley had sobbed into her mother's chest.
"Mammy, he tried to kill me. He tried to kill me. He put a bag over my head. I couldn't breathe. I thought I was going to die."
Moments later, the police had arrived on the scene, as Eric had wasted no time in informing the officers about what had actually occurred in the grove, and how Tyson had tried to kill his own stepsister. Now this monster of depravity, who had so nearly killed her daughter Ashley, was back again, parked nonchalantly in her driveway, in a red and black car. Chelsea was sure her whole family was in danger. She could taste it on her tongue, as surely as a snake detecting prey in its immediate vicinity. She listened to footfall that led up to the front door, the touch of leather on gravel. She waited and waited for the doorbell to ring and prayed that it would not. She glanced at the clock on her side table, confounded to see that it was 3:30 in the morning. "You've got to be kidding me," she thought. "I had no idea it was so late." Should she phone her daughter? Should she call the police? But before she gave those things any consideration, a loud knock could be heard on the front door that rudely disrupted her train of thought. The kind of unsettling pounding you heard on a horror movie, like Fright Night. If anyone woke up from their beds to hear a knock like that, it would mean only one thing, and that was to get the hell out of the house. Forget phoning the police. Don't waste time on any of that. You needed to grab every second by the hand and run as quickly as you could to safety. At breakneck speed, Chelsea hurriedly put on her sneakers, She heard the door downstairs begin to quiver and quake. The whole house began to rattle and shake precariously, as if it had been hit by a miniature earthquake. She knew that the door was being broken down by an axe. The sound was airy, like the substance of which your darkest nightmares are made from. Chelsea nimbly trotted down the staircase as quietly and as quickly as she could, her heart booming violently in her chest, sweat breaking out in beads above her top lip. Her blood had turned as cold as ice, and when she could see the head of an axe pounding down the door, her worst, most dreadful fears were confirmed. No one ever broke down your door, unless their intentions were to kill, steal, and destroy. She sensed the paralyzing urgency to get the hell out of the house. Thank God the family dog was with her husband, she thought. She surreptitiously slipped to the kitchen door, grabbing the torch she kept on the shelf for easy access. It was with slippery fingers she opened the door, sneakily creeping out, closing it discreetly behind her. But any noises were drowned out by the crashing sounds of the axe. She would have liked to have run to her car, driven far away, but she'd have been seen, and possibly grabbed, before she had a chance of escape. She had in mind to run through the trees of the grove, to the road and to another farmhouse to get help. She realized in her haste to get away from the looming danger. She had left her cell phone behind on the kitchen table. How could she have been so incredibly stupid? She could hear the explosive sound of the wood shattering as it surrendered to its deadly fate. The front door came crashing down. It was difficult to run, even with the adrenaline coursing through her veins. Her heart was skipping through her chest. Her legs felt as heavy as cinder blocks. But somehow she managed to drag her body through the trees. It was so tenebrific in the grove, so dreadfully dark. But she couldn't allow the looming shadows to intimidate her. She was so sure she was going around in circles, because she could not see where she was going. And if she kept the light of her torch on, she could easily be spotted. In a trice she saw a blinding light entering the trees obtrusively, its unwelcome beams tossing away the dark shadows like old blankets. The man was finally coming after her. She knew she needed to find a hiding place, but where? She crawled under a bramble bush, wincing out in pain, as the sharp thrusting barbs pierced through her skin, ripping through her flesh. But she thought hiding under this bush would be the surest way of not being seen. I mean, who searches a bush of brambles? People avoid bramble bushes like the plague, and this one had a small enough crawl space for Chelsea to climb under. She clung to the ground, anchoring herself tightly to the earthen soil. Her top was caught up in the brambles, her skin stinging out in pain, her heart thundering against the ground. She held her breath, terribly afraid that it could be heard. She heard the sound of a heavy boot callously thumping the ground as a man moved through the trees, his footfall getting closer and closer and closer. She could hear the pops and the snaps of twigs, the rustle of leaves, the rattle of the ground as the footsteps vibrated. The energy of the night suddenly became remarkably tense as the orchestra of crickets and frogs faded. Fear gripped Chelsea in such a tangible way as she clung helplessly to the ground. She was like an oyster on a rock, trying to make herself as inconspicuous and as small as she possibly could. "Please, God," she prayed, "don't let him see me. If he sees me, I'm dead." The light of the man's torch got brighter as he closed in on her, moving down the earthen paths. The powerful light of his torch unabashedly wrestled the dark shadows so that nothing remained hidden. It was one of the brightest lights Chelsea had ever beheld, and it held the darkness to ransom. She heard the sound of a throat being cleared, and then a cough. For a second the light shimmied over the bramble bush, as the heavy boots thundered past her and stopped. She opened her eyes, that had been clenched very tightly shut, as if willing the man away. But he was far too close for comfort. She could smell the stench of cigarette smoke on his person, the scotch on his breath. He was standing with his boots only a hair's breadth away from her, drenching the forest with his torchlight, running up and down through the trees, and even lighting up the branches in case Chelsea was hiding up in the trees. Chelsea was so uncomfortably close, she could easily have reached out to grab his ankle. "Go away, Tyson," she kept whispering in her mind. "For God's sake, Tyson, go away." But Tyson stood there, like a stubborn stone statue. He continued to feather the forest with the light of his torch, and she could feel he meant business, that he'd stop at nothing to find her. She could hear his heavy breathing, and from the large shape of his silhouette, he was no longer the lanky 12-year-old boy she'd once remembered. He was so much bigger now, so much more formidable, infinitely more dangerous. Chelsea did not know how it happened, but suddenly she had an urgent, desperate need to sneeze. She tried to suppress it, but out it came. And then the man turned around, his bright, invasive light, like a pair of car headlights, obliterated the darkness of the bramble bush where she was hiding. And moments later, she saw him. Her worst nightmare was realized as a face peered down at her. But the face was that of a man, not a boy, not the boy she remembered. Tyson's head was completely shaved. He was wearing a large vest that showed off his enormously threatening biceps that were covered in tattoos. He had earrings in his ears. He looked like a powerful bouncer you might find at a nightclub, capable of beating anyone within an inch of their lives if they ever stepped out of line. Even though Tyson looked ominously different, there was no mistaking those cold, dark eyes that were devoid of any emotion, that stared at her triumphantly.
"Well, well, well, look who we have here. Long time no see, Chelsea," said Tyson in a booming voice. "Look what the cat dragged in."
"What are you doing here, Tyson?" asked Chelsea. "Why don't you leave us alone? Go away, will you?"
"So she remembers me, does she? Well, that's a promising start, isn't it? Why don't I leave you alone? Is that a way a stepmother should talk to her stepson? That's not very nice, is it? I mean, you haven't seen me for many years, and this is the kind welcome I get. Even the prodigal son fared a lot better in the Bible, did he not? This is not the nice welcome I'd expect from you, Chelsea."
"You forget, Tyson, you are not my son. You only lived in our farmhouse for a year."
"Whose fault is that, Chelsea? As far as I remember, you couldn't wait to fob me off to the authorities, to get me locked up in a mental facility for a long, long time. How could you do that to your own stepson?"
It seemed strange to be talking to Tyson under a bush, but Chelsea knew that words might be the only thing that were left to save her. Could she make Tyson see sense? That was incredibly unlikely, but there was no harm in trying her best, keeping her wits about her.
"What did you expect me to do, Tyson? You were the one that put a bag over my daughter's head. You wanted to kill her. Do you honestly expect me to do nothing about that? You imposed a grave threat to our family. I had to take action. I didn't have a choice in the matter. You were out of control, Tyson."
"You couldn't wait to see the back of me, Chelsea. You were pleased when the police cuffed me and put me in the back of their car. I saw the expression on your face. You were satisfied. I'm sure you were hoping you would never, never see me again. Sorry, Chelsea, but some things have a habit of returning."
"I cared about you, Tyson. I really did. Why do you think I visited you at the psychiatric hospital? Because I cared about your welfare. But living with you was so difficult. You were like a snapping turtle. I was scared of getting bitten. We were all like that. You intimidated our lives. Why are you here? Why did you come here tonight? Why did you break down my door with an axe? Are you completely insane?"
"Why? You ask me why? That's a very good question, Chelsea. Why do I think you know the answer to the question you ask me? I'll tell you why. Do you remember when I was 12 years old? I looked you straight in the eye when you visited me at the psychiatric place, and I told you if I ever get out, that I'd be back, and that I'd get my revenge on you. Most especially you, Chelsea. I'm a man that keeps my word. The passage of time means absolutely nothing to me. When you were responsible for locking me away for years and years, I'm a man that keeps my word. The passage of time means absolutely nothing to me. When you were responsible for locking me away for years and years, time becomes irrelevant. It has absolutely no meaning at all. I've been wistfully dreaming and planning this night for many years, since I was 12 years old, and finally my moment has arrived, my opportunity to right a wrong, to get my blissful revenge. What happens to me afterwards is of no consequence to me, as long as I've hurt you. For you stole my life by ensuring I was locked away for years. I'm here to extend the very same courtesy you extended to me, by enjoying the privilege of taking the years from your life that you might have lived, like you took from me. But you're so predictable, Chelsea. It's ridiculous. I knew you would come and take cover here in the trees, but I was prepared for that. I came with a high-powered torch. I knew I would find you.
So what are you going to do to me, Tyson? Kill me? Is that the idea?
I'm going to have fun as I watch you die, like I very nearly watched Ashley succumb to her fate. But tonight, Chelsea, while your husband is out of town and the cat's away, the mice come out to play, do they not? And this mouse here is up for a very good time, let me tell you.
I don't care what you do to me, as long as you promise not to hurt my daughter Ashley and my husband. That's all I care about.
Tyson let out a cocky laugh.
I'm not going to make any promises to you, because I'd never keep them. I have no intention of hurting my father. But yes, I will be hurting Ashley. And I will be hurting Eric, because they deserve to die.
Tyson, the very fact that you're talking like this shows that you're not well in the head. How did they ever let you out of that place? You need help, you really do. You have no compassion in your heart whatsoever.
Do you think I don't know that? 1% of the population are exactly like me. I have no remorse, it's true. That's what makes this all so very easy. My new psychologist was a doddle. The last one was impossible to convince that I was well. But this one, he's easy to manipulate. I persuaded him that the very idea of harming another human being was repellent to me, and he believed my lies. See how easy it is to get over people, to manipulate them, to deceive them, to get them to do exactly what you want them to do. So here I am. And now, Chelsea, this is all about you. The two of us are going to have a great deal of fun tonight. So let's get the party started, shall we?
Please don't be like this, Tyson. Please be reasonable. Please have some mercy. Eric is such a good man. I don't want you to hurt him. And please don't hurt Ashley. She's got her whole life ahead of her. Don't hurt them, I beg you,
said Chelsea, trying to scramble away from under the brambles, in a desperate last-ditch effort to make her escape. But a couple of tenacious barbs held her firmly in place, their thorny needles anchoring her to the ground. Chelsea's heart grew heavy, and it was almost as if her heart ceased its beat. She found herself being ruthlessly dragged from under the bush. When Tyson grabbed her ankle, he yanked her out, while the needles ripped through her flesh. Her skin throbbed in pain. Tyson was now on top of her, pinning her down violently, grabbing her hands.
Tyson, don't Don't do this. Please. Please, I'm begging you.
It's too late for begging now, Chelsea. You showed no mercy on me. Why should I show mercy on you?
It wasn't like that, Tyson. You well know that. Why? Why are you doing this?
Chelsea's eyes widened when, sitting back on her haunches, with her hands tied behind her back with cable ties, she watched Tyson pull out a white plastic bag from his pocket. She knew what was going to happen next. She shook her head.
No, Tyson! Please! Please! You can't! You can't do this! You can't!
I think you will find I can, said Tyson, grinning. It may not have worked for your daughter, but it'll work for you. And I'm going to take a front row seat, watching you fight for your life in the grove. I tell you what, I'll make you a deal. He laughed merrily. If you can get the bag off your head, I'll let you live, Chelsea. That's fair, is it not?
Before Chelsea could react, she felt a plastic bag being pulled over her head and tightened. She was claustrophobic at the very best of times. This was not a good way to die. She didn't want to go out like this. She rolled on the ground, trying to find anything sharp or abrasive that might pierce the plastic. Where was that bramble bush? If she could get to it, maybe some of those thorns might pierce the plastic and take an eye out at the same time. But that would be a small price to pay to be able to breathe again. But where was that bramble bush? She couldn't see a thing. She crawled across the ground, but saw nothing. She was so terrified. Fear was clouding her judgment, robbing her of her reasoning. Chelsea knew panic was the reason so many little creatures lost their lives. Like a bird in a cat's jaws, they could die even before they were harmed. She must think. She mustn't lose it. If she did, she'd never get out of this bag. Where were those brambles? They could potentially save her, could they not? She couldn't breathe, and all she could hear was the manic laughing as Tyson clapped his hands, as he watched her using every effort to get the bag off her head. She didn't want to move around too frantically. She needed to conserve every morsel of oxygen. All of a sudden, breaking the silent monotony, was the sound of a thunderous roar that rudely ripped the silence apart with a vengeful ferocity. All of a sudden, she felt the plastic bag being shredded from her face, and she was able to imbibe the glorious fresh air. She began to cough and splutter as she hungrily seized the life-giving oxygen into her lungs, taking thirsty gulps. For a moment she thought she was hallucinating as a result of oxygen deprivation. She saw the Herculean-sized Bigfoot standing before her, larger than life, roaring at Tyson, whom had dropped the torch he was carrying on the ground. The torch fell into an upright position, so upright that the light filtered brazenly through the entire woodgrove, so everything that was hidden was now conspicuously bathed in an impertinent light.
Bloody hell! Bloody hell! What is that? What is that?
Came Tyson's terrified voice. Chelsea observed the Bigfoot clearly, almost forgetting about Tyson, as she stared at the incredulous creature that had come to her rescue with a wondrous sense of awe. She knew that Tyson was no match for this powerful beast. The Bigfoot was easily over 9 foot tall, with a human-looking face, high cheekbones, a protruding forehead that was heavily wrinkled, deep-set hooded eyes, feathered by fine lines. She could see the creature was absolutely incandescent with rage, greatly aggrieved by what Tyson had done to her. The Bigfoot began throwing his overlong arms in the air, shouting at Tyson in a language that downloaded itself into her head miraculously into English. How was it possible that she could understand every word that the Bigfoot was saying?
Killa killa qua, tilana kola, hi kasa qua. It's you again, after all this time. I knew you were bad news. Killa kikwa, hola, I warned you, if you ever played any of these funny games again, that you were dead. But did you take me seriously? What is wrong with your head? Kila kikwasa, ho bani kalaka, hi koto. Why is your thinking not aligned right? For there is no heartbeat in you. It's like you were born without one.
It was incredible for Chelsea to watch Tyson begging for his life.
Don't! Don't! Please don't hurt me! Please! Please don't hurt me!
It would seem the man wanted to run away, but was unable to do so. Chelsea suspected his legs felt like concrete blocks beneath him, like hers had done only moments before, when she had fled from the farmhouse. The Bigfoot threw Tyson over his arms. The man kicked and screamed in vain. The Bigfoot turned around to look directly at Chelsea, speaking to her again in his strange, rather curious language.
Kenatali nato, basikatwa, likilaniko. You don't need to see what I'm going to do to him. I'll take care of things for you. And by the way, tell your good friend with the horses that I appreciate him letting me select the right stalls for them. I know which ones they prefer.
And with that, he just glided away. 2 weeks later.
What's wrong? Asked Chelsea, as her husband Rick came into the kitchen.
You won't believe it, he said. The police have been on the phone to inform me that Tyson was found in the lake an hour away from here. He had drowned in a place where people regularly go fishing. A fisherman found him, would you believe it?
Chelsea had not shared with her husband what had happened, not because she wanted to keep the event from him secret, but because she was trying to get her head around what had actually transpired. She knew how distressed her husband had been when he'd learnt that Tyson had put a bag over their daughter's head all those years ago, and she didn't have the heart to tell him he'd done the very same thing to her. Especially knowing that Tyson was his son, as no father wants to believe his son is capable of so much evil.
That's incredible, said Chelsea, looking at her husband through narrowing eyes. I'm not going to pretend I'm sad, Rick. I'm really not. Tyson was bad news from the very beginning. You know he was. And with him alive, I know our lives would be in perilous danger. I'm sorry, but I do. And I'm sorry for you, Rick, as I know you care for him greatly, because he was your son, but...
That's just it, sweetheart. The police have informed me that he was never my son. The DNA data bank affirmed this only a short while ago.
Tyson was never your son, but I thought...
So did I. It turned out Rachel lied to me all along. I was never the boy's father. But as to why she did this, we will never know. I understand she died 5 years ago in a car accident. So some things we'll never know about.
Chelsea hugged her husband. Tears began to spill down her husband's cheeks.
It's just such a relief, you know, that I didn't father a monster after all. Is it bad that I feel this way, Chelsea?
Of course it's not. You have every right to feel this way. I'd feel the same if I was wearing your shoes.
I didn't tell you this, Chelsea, but I was secretly worried that Tyson was going to come after us. But it seems his mysterious drowning means we don't have to worry about a thing any more. I'm so relieved. I'm not going to kid.
Do the police suspect foul play in the manner of his death?
No, they believe it was an accident. The place where he was fishing was covered in rocks. Some treacherously slippery, I believe. They think he must have hit his head, was knocked out cold and drowned. It wouldn't be the first time this happened. I believe his fishing tackle was found close to the scene. But according to the officer, his girlfriend, whom he befriended online, insisted he's never fished a day in his life. So I think he was keeping secrets from his fancy woman.
That's incredible, said Chelsea, taking her husband lovingly into her arms. We can begin a new chapter in our lives, knowing that the thing we feared the most is now behind us.
Thank God for that, Rick agreed.
So there you are. That's my story. Wow, what an incredible story. And what an incredible farm, where all these wonderful things happened with a Bigfoot who gave Eric pawpaws, who looked after the horses, made sure that they had the perfect stalls, who protected two people from being killed by this really awful young man called Tyson, who came back to wreak his revenge on Chelsea. And she just knew he was going to come back, and he did as she predicted. But she had not predicted that there would be a large, hairy man to save her from the likes of Tyson, who clearly had a psychopathic disorder which could not be wiped out. You know, once you have this kind of condition, you can't suddenly become a loving, kind human being because it's inbuilt in your DNA, I think. So what an extraordinary story.
Well, hello there. I hope you enjoyed the Omnibus edition. We've got many more coming our way for you to listen to. Sending you love wherever you are in the world, in North America, Canada, Kenya, wherever you may be, I send you lots and lots of love. Thank you for listening to my Omnibus, and I really do hope you enjoyed it, because that's the whole idea about it, is to give you some interesting stories to listen to. So until next time, goodbye and good night.